All right, so good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the first session on matrices. Now, people who have already done this in school would be should be able to answer this question. What do you understand from a matrix? How do you define a matrix? So we all know it's an array of numbers, right? It's an array of numbers, and in fact, it's an array of some physical quantity, right? Why I'm saying physical quantity is because it could be scalar quantity, it could be vector quantity, correct? It could also have complex numbers, real numbers as its elements. So what is a matrix? Matrix is nothing but it's an array of physical quantities. Okay, right? And these quantities, which are also called as the elements of the array or members of the array, right? They could be vectors, they could be scalars. Okay, so these physical quantities can be vectors. Okay, they could be scalars as well. Okay, so let's not have any kind of a doubt that only matrices can be formed out of scalar quantities. It can be formed out of vector quantities also. Okay, and not only that, your quantities could be real numbers, or it could be imaginary numbers or non-real numbers also. Okay, now why do we need a matrix? Let's say if I give you a matrix like this, let's say 2 0 0 3. Okay, what do you understand from this? Anybody? Why it is actually used? Is it just used to maintain a list having some rows and columns, right? For example, if my mom gives me a certain grocery item to purchase, so she will give me the name of the item, how many kgs I need to buy, and probably she will give me the money as per what is the rate of those substances. So is that what an array is, what an matrix is meant for? As a science student, as an engineering student, do you think that is the application of matrices for you? Why do we need matrices? What do you understand when somebody tells you that there's a matrix like this? What do you understand from it? Yeah, take a guess.
To organize data.
It's an organized data. Okay, so do you think a science student needs to know how to organize data without any application to it? Okay, now this is a drawback that we most of us carry when we don't understand why we are studying matrices. See, matrices are basically agents of linear transformation. So let me write it down very clearly over here. Matrices are agents of linear transformation. Okay, what is the meaning of the word linear transformation? This is a very difficult word to digest in first go. See, when I see this, basically I see my 2D space, right, transformed in such a way that, see, what is the 2D space? 2D space is made up of X and Y, right? And what is the basis vector for X axis? What is the unit vector for X axis, so as to call it?
I cap,
right? I cap. Most of you would have done it in physics, I cap, right? And what is the basis vector for this?
J cap,
right? See, what is basis vector? Basis vector is basically the vectors which you replicate to generate the entire 2D space. Correct. For example, if I want to generate a point, let's say 2, 3. Okay. Basically, it is generated when I move 2 units along the X axis and probably 3 units along the Y axis. Right. Are you getting my point? So any vector in this is basically a position vector. You can call this as a position vector. Okay. So any vector in your 2D space, or for that matter, if I give you a 3 by 3, it would be a 3D space. that is obtained by basically some basis vectors or unit vectors, what we call it. Okay. Now, when I say I'm basically making a matrix like this, now this is basically a matrix which changes your unit vector along the x-axis by 2 times and unit vector along the y-axis by 3 times. That means instead of having a 1x1 grid, it transforms this space in such a way that now your grid becomes 2x3 grid. Are you getting my point? So it is linearly transforming the space. Okay. Now, linearly transforming the space means it is trying to change your basis vectors, which is making the entire space. And when it is doing that, it basically changes every vector lying on the space. So if, let's say, if I had a vector 2, 3, then this vector would have changed it to, I think most of you would have done matrix multiplication, it would have changed it to 4, 9. So this point 2, 3 in this new system will now go to 4, 9. Are you getting my point? Okay, I'll show you something very interesting over here.
Sir, is it like shifting of origin?
No. Origin doesn't shift. Only the basis vectors, they stretch or they contract. Right? Okay. They may become oblique also, but there is no shift of origin. Right? So linear transformation just changes your x, y to ax plus by kind of a vector. I'll just show you something very interesting. You'll be able to relate to that. Let me open my GeoGebra. Okay, so all of you please pay attention over here. I'll show you something very interesting. Let's say this is my 2D space, correct? Okay, now what I'm going to do is on this 2D space, I'm going to drop a picture. Okay, let's say, yeah. By the way, she's my daughter, so I'm taking a picture, okay, and I'm dropping it over here. Okay, fine. Now, every pixel in this image is basically a position vector. For example, her eyes will have a position vector, right? Her nose will have a position vector. Okay, so every spot on this image is having a position vector. Okay, now let's say I want to transform this linear space. Let's say I want to make her fatter. Okay, so see what I'll do. Let me just rename her pick something. Let's call it as P. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to now make her fatter through the use of matrices. So I will write a vector, or I'll write a matrix F for fat. Okay. See what I'll do. Okay. As you can see, I've written some matrix. Fine. Now I'll apply this matrix F to her image P. See what happened. Do you see that? Her image became distorted. Now what happened? Basically, I wrote such a matrix over here, which linearly transformed the space in such a way that any position vector on it, let's say any position vector x, y on it, after getting linearly transformed by this matrix, became 2xy. That means it became elongated twice along the x-axis, but it did not elongate along the y-axis. Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Matrices are, are a very, very important tool in field of digital image processing, artificial intelligence. Lot of field matrices are being used now. I come from electrical background, so I use it in image processing. Okay. So whatever tools you use, your Picasa, Photoshop, or let's say after taking a photograph, you want to increase the contrast, or, try to make yourself look, a little bit taller or, thinner. They're all done through matrices actually working at the backdrop. Now, let's say I want to flip her image about the, about the let's say y axis. What will I do? Tell me. Anybody can
hint? Minus one and x. Replace x and y with minus one.
Excellent. Very good. See, now what I'll do is I'll erase this. Let's say g, and as Anjali rightly said, I'll make a vector. Now I have to change, I have to reflect her image about the y-axis, means I have to change x with minus x, right? So I'll make a vector like, I'll make a matrix like this, see. Okay. Now I'll apply g to her image p. See, it got mirror image. Okay. I can do anything. I can make her taller by stretching it, right? Can you tell me something to reflect her image about x-axis? What will I do? Tell me.
Same thing, but instead of making that one minus one, make the other thing minus one.
Okay, 1, 0 and 0, -1. Correct? Okay. 0, -1. And apply this to...
-1, sir.
Oh, I'm so sorry. So sorry. Apply this matrix T to her image. Okay, as you can see, it has now gone down. Okay. Can you see that? Okay. You can also, you know, rotate her image, right? You can also, take the mirror image of the, you know, whatever transformations you can think of, you can apply it through the use of matrices. Okay. So we'll talk about these application in the last part of matrices. I think in the last class of matrices, which might be the next class. But remember, my dear students, matrices are not there for you to arrange data. It is not there for you to make a list of what grocery items you are going to purchase. They have scientific applications. And they are very powerful tools, very, very powerful tools. Okay. So let us begin with this understanding about matrices. So from now onwards, you should not take it very lightly that, okay, you can go home and do it on your own. It has got very tricky concepts, which we'll discuss in today's class also. First, we'll talk about types of matrices. Probably this part will be very easy for you. But it is important because when I'll be referring to these matrices, you should know their names. Okay. So what are the types of matrices? We'll first start with a row matrix. I'll just be quick over here because we all know this. So what's a row matrix? Which has got only one row in it, and it can have any number of columns. So it has one row, right? But it can have any number of columns and any number of columns. To take an example, something like 1, 5, 7. This is a row matrix. Okay. Column matrix. What's a column matrix? Having only one column. Only one column. And any number of rows. Any number of rows. Sir, what would happen to our image if there were no zeros at all? What is the meaning of zeros there, Sai?
The elements, 0, 2 and 3, 0, right? Those.
No, every image, every element of her pixel is basically a position vector. So when you're changing your space, let's say you are expanding it along x-axis or y-axis, any kind of squishing whatever you do with the space, it will be applied to every vector on it. So what is happening? Her image is getting distorted because of that.
Oh, okay, sir.
Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So matrices are basically changing the space so that everything on that space is getting distorted. So image processing is one of the, very, very commonly used application of matrices. Of course, data analysis is also involved, but that's because I come from, circuit background. I was giving you idea about image. Probably if you talk to a person who has done artificial intelligence like Tushar sir, he will give you a different idea altogether about, the use of matrices. But what I wanted to say, it's not a simple, just listing down of numbers in rows and columns. It has much more uses to it. Yeah. So okay, column matrix example would be something like 1, 5, 7. Normally we write our vectors having 3 dimension as a column matrix. Okay. Next is basically a rectangular matrix. Just know the names. It is not that it's going to be very, very important for a school or this thing. So what's a rectangular matrix? Now, how do you represent a matrix? I think I should have told you that first. So a matrix is basically represented by a capital alphabet A or B or whatever, right? And we write it like this. Aij basically signifies the element of that matrix present in ith row and jth column. Okay. M signifies the number of rows in the matrix. N signifies the number of columns in that matrix. You are already aware of these, you know, concepts in your junior classes. Okay. So a rectangular matrices are those matrices where the number of rows are not equal to the number of columns. Now there are two types of rectangular matrices. One is basically horizontal matrix. Let me write it in different color. Horizontal matrix. Okay. In horizontal matrix, basically the number of columns will be more than the number of rows. Okay. So here the number of columns would be more than the number of rows. For example, something like this is a horizontal matrix. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. As you can see, this is a 2x3 matrix. Number of columns are more than the number of rows. Okay. There can be something called vertical matrix. Vertical matrix. Okay. So vertical matrix basically is one where your number of rows will be more than the number of columns. So something like this will be a vertical matrix. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So number of rows would be more than the number of columns. Okay. Now, the important one for us is this matrix called square matrix. Square matrices would be the most commonly used matrices by us. I think you have done determinants also, NPS Sajaji Nagar. Determinants are found only for square matrices. Okay. In fact, the special type of matrices which we'll study today, like symmetric matrix, Q-symmetric, Hermitian, Q-Hermitian, they are all square matrices only. Okay. So what's a square matrix? Basically, where your number of rows and number of columns are equal. That's a square matrix. Okay. In square matrix, one thing that we all need to know, there is something called the leading diagonal or the principal diagonal. Let me take an example of a square matrix. Let's say 3, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1. Okay. This diagonal is basically what we call as the leading diagonal. Leading diagonal. Okay. Also called as the principal diagonal. Principal. P-A-L. Okay. Principal diagonal. Okay. Now, for a square matrix, the sum of the elements in the leading diagonal is called the trace. So what is a trace? Trace of a square matrix is nothing but it is the sum of the elements in the leading diagonal. We'll talk about trace in some time. Okay. Sum of the elements in the leading diagonal is called the trace. any question about the square matrix?
Why should determinants be only found for square matrix?
We'll talk about it. Determinants, determinants also have their own physical significance just like matrices have. So determinants give a number that basically tells you that how is your, see, when you have a 1x1 square in a grid, okay? When you make a transformation on that linear space, then the same unit, you can say unit parallelogram, how would the area of that getting changed because of that transformation? That factor is basically told by the determinant value. I would request all of you to watch this video by 3 blue 1 brown. Sorry, 3 brown 1 blue or 3 blue 1 brown, something like that.
3 blue 1 brown.
3 blue 1 brown. Yeah, they have given a very, very, you know, pictorial and animated view of how vectors and determinants are to be perceived. In 11th and 12th, we get a very, very wrong picture about matrices and determinants. And let me tell you, this chapter is again going to come in your first year of engineering. Okay, so matrices are going to come again in first year of engineering. All right, next is null matrix or zero matrix. Okay, what is a null matrix or a zero matrix? Basically, a matrix of order, any order, let's say M cross N, such that all elements of this matrix are zero. Okay. Normally, we represent this matrix by O. Okay. Don't confuse it with zero. It is O. Okay. Represented by O. So this plays the same, you know, role that basically a zero number will play in terms of our common, you know, used numbers. Okay. That depends upon the space which you are dealing with. Next is diagonal matrix. What's a diagonal matrix? Now, NPS, I would like you to tell me, what have you learned about a diagonal matrix? What has been told to you about the diagonal matrix?
Sir, so only in the principal diagonal, there'll be elements and everything else should be zero.
Everything else should be zero. Okay. Now, many books will write this definition. By the way, diagonal matrix are basically called sparse matrix because they have zero in most of the places. And as Sahana rightly mentioned, the elements are only present in the diagonal position, or you can say non-zero elements are only present in the diagonal positions. Rest, all the elements are going to be zero. So basically, a diagonal matrix is first of all a square matrix. First of all, a square matrix. Okay. And it follows this algorithm that if I is not equal to J, the element would be zero. Correct. Okay. And if I is equal to J, the element should not be zero. Now, this is slightly controversial. Many people, they claim that the elements in the diagonal position may be zero. Okay. But element in the non-diagonal position must definitely be zero. So I've seen this controversy in many places, in Quora also, Math Stack Exchange also, people are debating about it. But see, the idea here is that normally in a diagonal matrix, people say that these three elements should not be zero and rest of the elements should be zero. But this is a controversial thing. However, it has not hurt anybody because of this controversy. Okay. But if you want it to be invertible, then none of the elements should be zero. Now, what is invertible matrix? Probably NPS Rajaji Nagar would be aware of it, but not Yashwantpur. Are you aware of what is invertible matrix?
Yeah, she taught invertible matrix.
Okay. Now, I'll tell you some very good characteristic about a diagonal matrix. Diagonal matrix, because there are a lot of sparse, you know, values over here, that means the values are zero, it is represented as D-I-A-G. And when you just write your elements, let's say A, B, C, it is obvious, it is very, you know, clear that it will only have A, B, C in the diagonal positions. Okay. So many times, you know, you don't have to write all unnecessary zeros. Now, the characteristic of a diagonal matrix, let me name it as, let's say, a diagonal matrix D. Okay, let's say I'll take an example of a diagonal matrix whose diagonal positions are A1, A2 till AN. Let's say it's an N by N square matrix, which is a diagonal matrix. The very important characteristic is, if you raise it to any positive integer powers, the direct impact can be seen on the elements. Okay. Let me not choose n, let me choose k so that we don't mix it with the order. Okay. And this is applied even if you are inverting the matrix. So if you want to reciprocate, or if you want to, the reciprocate word is basically synonymous with, if you want to invert the matrix, okay? Of course, we don't do one by the matrix. There is a separate operation which we call as the inverse, finding the inverse of the matrix. Then if you are finding the inverse of the matrix, the diagonal elements would simply get inverted. So it'll become 1 by A1, 1 by A2, and so on till 1 by A n. Okay. This may not be shown by all the matrices. This may not be shown by all the matrices. Okay. So Aniruddha has asked, what is the significance of diagonal matrix? We'll talk about leading diagonal. So there is something called eigenvectors and all, which we'll study in some time. There you'll understand the importance of the leading diagonal. Aditya, which part you want me to go to?
No, sir. I copied it. Yeah.
In case I forget forget to see the chat, please do remind me by speaking out. Okay. Okay. So Venkat has a question, sir. Can the matrix have non-zero elements in the non-leading diagonal and zero in the? No. See, Venkat, this is the definition which basically is given by many of the authors which I have seen. For example, this is the definition given by Amit Agarwal. Okay, Amit Agarwal says the leading diagonal elements should not be zero. But some books, I'll just write out where, some books and in some, you know, you can say, you know, websites, let me write sources, they say that the non-leading diagonal positions must be zero. Okay, that is what they write. They don't say anything about the diagonal or leading diagonal elements. Okay, they may or may not be zero is what they say. Okay, so that's why I asked NPS Rajaji Nagar, what has been told to you in school?
So we wasn't told anything. We learned it ourselves.
Okay, what does NCRT state?
Yeah, I think the first definition.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. Because many books I have seen, even I have read through the books of Cengage and all, they just say the non-leading diagonal should be zero. What about leading diagonal element? They may or may not be zero. Nothing has been specified about them. Okay. So this is something which basically is a peculiar characteristic of a diagonal matrix. In fact, later on you'll learn matrix polynomials. Right? What is matrix polynomial? I'll talk about it. But let's say if you are finding I'll just give you an example. This is a very interesting property of diagonal matrix. See, f here is a function. Let's say it's a polynomial. Let's say I give a polynomial like this. X square plus x plus 2. Okay. Right. So if you replace your x with a diagonal matrix, then what happens? Every element of the diagonal matrix in the leading diagonal position will undergo the same treatment. Okay. For example, if your diagonal matrix was, I'll just give you an example of, you know, something like this. 1, 2. Okay. So if you want to find FD, okay, then basically what will happen is you'll again get a diagonal matrix whose elements will be 1 square plus 1 plus 1, which is 4, and 2 square plus 2 plus 2, which is how much? 8, right? Are you getting my point? Okay, so as to say that if you're doing d square plus d plus 2i, then you'll end up getting this expression. Okay, we'll talk about matrix polynomial in some time when we are talking about multiplication of matrix. But since I was talking about diagonal matrix, I thought I would introduce you to these properties. Is it fine? Any questions here? Anybody? Okay. Now, a special type of diagonal matrix is basically a scalar matrix. Let me write it down. Scalar matrix. What is a scalar matrix? Scalar matrix is basically, again, a square matrix. Number one, it should be a square matrix. Okay. And the property of this matrix is, let's say I talk about a square matrix of order n. By the way, when I say square matrix of order n, means what is the number of rows and what is the number of columns?
N and each.
N and each, right. Okay. So it's just like saying that A is a, I'll write it down over here. It just implies that A is basically a matrix of this nature. Okay. So scalar matrix basically satisfies this property. The element satisfies this property. It would be zero if I is not equal to J. And it would be K if I is equal to J, and K should not be zero. And K should not be zero. Okay. So a typical example of this could be 3, 3, 3, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay. So as you can see, it's a diagonal matrix, but having the same element in the leading diagonal position. So these all elements are same. Okay. This is a matrix which you will realize when you are doing adjoint of a matrix into A. Okay. We'll talk about it when we are doing determinants. In fact, when we are doing adjoint of a matrix also. Okay. A special type of scalar matrix where K is 1 is basically called a unit matrix or identity matrix. So next is a unit matrix or identity matrix. Okay. So what is this? Basically, again, it's a square matrix. It's a square matrix. And it is a special type of scalar matrix where all elements in the non-diagonal positions are zero, and all elements in the leading diagonal positions are one. Okay. It plays the same role as the identity element. Now, what is an identity element? NPS, YPR, have you done binary operations? No?
No, sir.
No. Okay. See, identity elements are basically those elements of that given set which, when applied, now they can be a binary operation. For example, let's say 0 is an identity element for addition on real numbers. So if you take any real number, add a 0 to it, it'll give you the same real number, right? So we say that 0 is an identity element
for addition.
Identity element for addition on real numbers, or the binary operation of addition on real numbers. Similarly, 1 is an identity element for multiplication on real numbers, right? In the same way, I is basically an identity element for multiplication, okay, on square matrices. Okay, so if you are applying, let's say, multiplication on two square matrices, then on that type of operation, I will play the role of the identity matrix or identity element. Okay, just like O will play the role of identity element for addition between two matrices of the same order. We'll talk about it when I talk about addition also. Okay. Normally, we represent it by IN, where N specifies the order. Okay. So, for example, I2, if you say, it means 1, 0, 0, 1. This is I2. I3, if I say, it means 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay. So, this is the identity matrix of order 2, identity matrix of order 3, depending upon, you can go on to any N by N matrix. Okay. Next, we'll talk about operations on matrices. Operations on matrices. By the way, the list is not over. There are some special type of matrices which we'll understand in some time after we have done some operations, because they are known from the operations done on them. I don't know whether you have been introduced to nilpotent, involutory, idempotent, all those stuff. Have you been introduced, NPS?
Idempotent is...
No, I don't think so.
Okay. No problem. We'll talk about it. So let's look at some operations on matrices. The first operation is equality of two matrices. So when you say matrix A is equal to matrix B, okay, it can only happen if the number of rows of A is equal to the number of rows of B. Number one, number of rows of A should be equal to number of rows of B. Okay. And secondly, number of columns of A should be equal to number of columns of B. Okay. In other words, they should be of the same order. Okay. That is, A and B must be of the same order. This is one criteria. Okay, so let me call this as criteria number one. Second criteria is every element of A must be equal to the corresponding element of B. Right? So when each of the elements of A and B are correspondingly equal to each other, then only we can say the two matrices are equal. Now, there is no relation like one matrix being greater than or less than other matrix. Inequality properties do not hold good. Okay. So just a simple example to take. If somebody says, let's say X, Y, Z, W is equal to X 6 minus 1, 2W. And I ask you, what is the value of these elements X, Y, Z, W and all? What will you say?
You can't find out.
Oh, just one second. I'll give you a value for this. Let's say 4.
W is 0.
Yeah. So in this case, you'll compare element with element. So you'll say X is equal to 4, Y is equal to 6, Z is equal to 1. And since W is 2W, means W is equal to 0. Okay. So only by comparison, you can basically find out the values of these elements. Now, this is a very simple concept. Let's not waste too much time on it. Next, we'll talk about addition of matrices. Now, let's say when you are adding two matrices A and B, they can only be added to each other, or what we say in the language of mathematics as that they are confirmable to be added or confirmable for addition. Okay. So if A and B are confirmable for addition, it can only happen when number one, order of A should be equal to order of B. Okay. And secondly, let's say if you get an answer C, then C will also be of the same order as A and B. Okay. So in addition, the outcome is also of the same species as whatever has been added. For example, mango plus mango can give mango only. It cannot give us banana, right? And secondly, every element of C is made by the sum of the corresponding position elements of matrix A and B. For example, let's say first row second column element is obtained by adding first row second column of A with the element present in the first row second column of B. Okay. A simple example I would like to give here. Let's say we have 1, 2, 3, 4. And let's say you are adding it to minus 1, 6, 7, 9. Okay. So first of all, are they of the same order? Yes, then only we can add it. And how they are added? You basically add element to element. So this is 0, 8, 10, 13. Okay. Nothing very great about it. Some properties we will have to know about addition of matrix. Let's look into the properties. Matrix addition. If you feel I'm going slightly faster, please stop me. Okay. The concept is very easy. That's why I'm moving in a slightly faster pace. Why not? We can have a 1x1 diagonal matrix. Why not? Diagonal matrix is basically a square matrix. It can be 1x1, 2x2, 3x3, whatever. Got it, Dhyan? Okay. So what are the properties of matrix addition? Number one, matrix addition is commutative. That means it doesn't make a difference whether you are doing A plus B or B plus A. The result is the same. Okay, provided they are confirmable for addition. Fine. Number two, matrix multiplication is associative. What is the meaning of associative? If you do A plus B,
any order.
Yeah. If you do A plus B and then add it to C, it is same as doing A plus B plus C. It doesn't make a difference to it. Okay. Then there is something called the existence of additive identity. Additive identity.
Null matrix.
The null matrix of the same order as A or B. Okay. So what is an additive identity for a matrix addition? It's basically a matrix O, which is of the same order as, you know, A. For example, let's say A plus O is A, then this O will be a null matrix of the same order as A. Let's say A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then the additive identity for this would be 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Are you getting my point? Okay. So I don't think so there would be any question on this, but if let's say they ask you, what do you think is the additive identity for this matrix? Okay. Don't write any order null matrix. It should be of the same order. Next is existence of additive inverse. Existence of additive inverse. So what is the additive inverse of a matrix A? So basically a matrix which added to that gives you the additive identity for the same matrix. For example, if I say, for this matrix A, what do you think is the additive inverse?
Minus A.
Right.
A minus.
Yeah. So this would be the additive inverse of A. So as you can see, additive inverse of A would be minus of A. So in this case, in our given example, it would be minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6. Okay. Minus of A means you just change the sign of every element of that given matrix. Basically, it comes under the concept of scalar multiplication, which I'm going to take next after this. Next property is the cancellation laws hold good. The cancellation laws hold good. What is the meaning of cancellation law hold good? See, if I say A plus B is equal to A plus C. Okay. Right. Normally from here, we can say B is equal to C. This is called left hand cancellation law or left cancellation law. Left cancellation law.
Why, sir?
Okay. Because you can cancel the left hand terms, the terms to the left of these terms. So whatever are left will be equal. Okay. Similarly, if I say B plus A is equal to C plus A, then it can be concluded that B is equal to C by cancelling A from the right sides of these terms. So this is called the right cancellation law. So both these right cancellation and left cancellation law, they hold good for matrix addition. But you will learn in some time that they do not hold good for multiplication. Okay. Now things may seem very trivial. Oh sir, this is very obvious. No, why we are learning this? It's not very obvious. Matrices, they don't follow the same, you know, laws and rules as normal numbers follow. Okay. You'll see in some time what are the exceptions that matrices show. Okay. Now I'm not covering a subtraction because subtraction is basically adding one matrix to the negative of the other. So I'm not covering it separately. I'll directly jump now to scalar multiplication. Any question with respect to this?
No, sir.
So next is scalar multiplication. Scalar multiplication, basically, when you have a matrix A, let's say, of order m cross n, right? And if you take k as a scalar quantity and do this ka, okay, this is called scalar multiplication. What happens in scalar multiplication? All the elements of the matrix get multiplied with that scalar quantity k. Okay, for example, let's say if your A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And if I say, give me 2a, then what are you going to do? You're going to multiply each and every element of this matrix by 2. So it'll become 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Correct? Now this property is slightly different from what we follow in determinants. I don't know whether you have done determinants, but in determinants, only one row or one column could be multiplied with k. Okay, in a determinant, when you multiply by a scalar quantity k, only one row or only one column of your choice can be multiplied with that k. But in matrices, all the elements of the matrix have to be multiplied with that k. Is that fine? Okay, some small properties we can list it out as notes, properties of scalar multiplication. Initial part is very easy, Venkat. Achha, many people take this chapter very, very lightly. Let me tell you, two questions will come in JEE Main. Two questions will come in JEE Main and two questions will come in JEE Advance on this topic. Okay. So not to be taken lightly. 8 marks will be, you know, definitely coming from this topic. Right. So if you multiply a sum of two matrix A and B with a scalar quantity lambda, then it is as good as multiplying them separately with lambda and adding it. Okay. And let's say if you have two scalar quantities, then you basically can write it separately also like this. These are all simple properties to deal with. So if you have lambda multiplied to, let's say, mu A, you can write this as mu times lambda A. That means you can apply some kind of, you know, associative property over here. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
What happens when you add a scalar to a matrix?
You can't add it, no.
Okay, thank you.
Addition will always happen between two quantities of the same nature. It's like asking what will happen when you add bananas to apples. Right. You can't add them. Okay. Yeah. So quantities of the same nature can only be added.
So one doubt regarding cancellation law.
Yes.
Sir, isn't it just redundant because it's commutative either ways?
Redundant means?
Like, whether the law exists or not, it won't matter, right? The cancellation law.
See, when you cancel out some stuff, basically we try to take the root what we follow in numbers. Okay. And in case of addition, yes, as you are right, it is commutative. It's not going to make much of a difference. But where commutativity fails, for example, in matrix multiplication, there it may matter to you. Right? So yes.
Okay, sir.
Anita, you're right that because of the fact that they are commutative, the cancellation law basically hold true. Okay. But when you study linear algebra to a higher level, I think you'll be studying in undergraduate, you would realize that rules are very tricky there. Okay, what we normally apply for numbers may not work for matrices. Fine?
Right.
Yeah, so last property, as you can see, if you do minus scalar quantity into A, it doesn't matter whether you treat it any one of these ways. All of them are treated in the same way. Next, we'll go into some serious part of this chapter. These were all very simple. Matrix, multiplication of matrices. Multiplication of matrices. This is very important because the major property of transformation is basically hidden in this particular, you know, operation. So when you're transforming a matrix, when you're transforming a scalar vector quantity or a position vector or whatever, you are basically doing a pre facto or a post facto multiplication with a matrix. Now, how is the matrix multiplication done? Most of you are already aware of it. So let's say A is a matrix which is of order m cross n, and B is a matrix of order, I'm just taking some, you know, random order, let's say p cross q. Okay. If you are multiplying these two matrices, then the conformability test for this is that the number of columns of the prefacto. So when you're multiplying AB, A is called the prefacto, B is called the postfacto. Okay. So the number of columns of the prefacto must be equal to the number of rows of the postfacto. Right. So the conformability test is.
So what is it called?
This A.
Yeah, you said pre something.
Prefacto.
Oh, okay.
Prefacto, postfacto. Prefacto, postfacto. Okay. Fine. So the conformability for multiplication is. The number of columns of the second should be equal to the number of rows of the first. Okay. That means N and P should be the same. So let me rephrase it now. So A is basically, let's say Aij M cross N. Then B should be Bij N cross Q. Okay. And the resultant matrix C would be of the order M cross Q. That is M here and Q here. That would become the order of the resultant matrix. Now, how do you find the elements of the resultant matrix? I'm sure your book has mentioned a summation process in this case, which is nothing but Aik into Bkj, where K is basically starting from 1 and going all the way till the number of rows of the second or columns of the first. So basically it goes from 1 to n. Okay. And I basically goes from 1 to n. I goes from 1 to n. And J will go from 1 to Q. Okay. Now let me show you an example how it works. Let's say this is your A and this is your B. Are they conformable to be multiplied? Yes, it is a 2x2 and this is also 2x2. Okay, so how does matrix multiplication happen? All of you please pay attention, those who have not done this before. What we do, we start with, follow the symbol. So take the row of the first, multiply it with the column of the second. So 2 will multiply to 5, 1 will multiply to 1, and they will get added up. Okay. So if you take the first row of A and first column of B, then whatever answer you are writing, you are going to write in the first row, first column position. So if you take the first row and second column, you will write the answer in the first row, second column of C, like this. Similarly, if you take the second row and first column, then you will write your answer in the second row, first column of C. Okay, so the idea is clear. Whichever row you are taking from A and whichever column you are taking from B, after multiplying the corresponding elements, you have to write it in the same row, column position of the answer matrix. So this will come 3 into 2 plus 5 into 7. Okay. If I'm not mistaken, this is 11. This is also 11. This is 20. And this is going to be 41. So this will become your, you know, resultant matrix. Are you getting my point here? Okay. Now, some properties which are very, very important and direct questions can come on them in competitive exams. Let's look into that. Let me write it in the previous page only.
So actually, I had a doubt.
Yeah.
So if we have to find out like the cube of a matrix, so first we find out A square, and then to find out A cube, do we multiply A square with A or A with A square?
Very good. Your answer would be obtained in this property which I am going to tell you.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So properties of matrix multiplication. Properties of matrix multiplication. Okay, the first property is, in general, matrix multiplication is not commutative. So it's not commutative. Let me write it like this. Not commutative in general. In general means, in some cases, they may be commutative, but generally they are not commutative. That means AB need not give you same answer as BA. Okay, and especially in those cases where, you know, your orders are, you know, in such a way that if you switch the positions, the conformability condition may get violated. Okay, so in those cases, of course, AB and BA will not give you the same result. Okay, now even when A and B are square matrix, this result may not hold true. Now coming to Anjali's question. When you do A to the power N, first of all, let me tell you what is the meaning of this. It means, of course, N has to be a positive integer. Okay. It means that you're multiplying A to itself N number of times. A to the power N doesn't mean you're raising every element to the power N. No, that is not the meaning of A to the power N. A to the power, let's say if I say A to the power 3, it means I'm multiplying A with A with A. Okay. Now the next property is going to help us, you know, answer question of Anjali. Her question was, if I do A cube, whether do you do A square into A or A into A square? Okay. So the answer is hidden in the fact that matrix multiplication is associative. What is the meaning of associative? Associative means if you do A, B and then multiply with a C, it is not going to change even if you do this, provided, of course, they should be all conformable to be multiplied. Okay. Now, to answer Anjali's question, A cube is basically A into A into A. So whether you do this or whether you do this, your answer is not going to change. So whether you do A square into A or whether you do A into A square, in this case, your answer is not going to change because of this associative property. Did you get your answer, Anjali? No?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So it doesn't matter whether you do A square into A or you do A into A square. End result would be the same. It is because they follow associative property. Now, in associative property, one thing I would like to add over here. So let's say if A is a M cross N, B is a N cross P, and let's say C is P cross Q, right? Then the resultant would be, let's say, a matrix which will be of the order M cross Q. Okay, so the rows of this and the columns of this would be the resultant matrix. So the same trend is being followed. Okay. Yes, Venkat, you're saying something?
Yes, I had a doubt.
Yeah, tell me.
Could you go up and the commutative property, please?
Yeah, sure.
So we know that multiplication identity is one, right? Unit matrix of the same order.
Yes.
So, you know, like, and unit we also know that...
Unit matrix is always square matrix.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So, in order to make the matrix multiplication associative, can't we just multiply both sides with unit matrix?
Not unit anchor, just a matrix full of ones.
No. Yeah, you're not getting the fact here. Unit matrix term itself is applied only to a square matrix. Unit matrix is always a square matrix.
Oh, okay.
So, if you're multiplying anything to a unit matrix, make sure it is conformable, first of all, to be multiplied. Okay? It is not like, you know, a number that you can multiply with anything to get the same answer. No. It must be conformable, first of all, to be multiplied. Yeah? Now, what is your question?
You cleared it here.
You got your answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, even I had a doubt.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, you said, but if you exchange it like that, then M and Q will change, no, sir?
No, it will not change. No, that's the point. If you multiply A and B first, as you can see, the number of columns here is same as the number of rows over here, right? And if you do this, let's say BC, the number of columns here will be same as the number of rows here. Correct. So conformability test is not disturbed. Got it, Arpita?
Yes, sir. Got it.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, if all of them are transpose matrices, then also would this rule be applicable?
What is the meaning of transpose matrix? There is a transpose of a matrix. What is transpose matrix in itself?
Sir, is it like rows become all columns and columns?
So you find transpose of a matrix, right?
Yes, sir.
There's no matrix called transpose matrix. There's nothing like inverse matrix. There's like inverse of a matrix is there. Correct? Now, yes, what? Sir. So what is your question? If you transpose a matrix, then you get another matrix. Then what do you do with that?
So the same thing like how you wrote here now, sir. If you find transpose of A, B and C would still give D transpose of D M into Q.
Okay, now the order will be different in that case. It will go from the reverse direction. We'll talk about it under those properties. Don't worry. Today we are going to talk a lot about transpose properties. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So what you are talking is basically something which we call as law of reversal. Okay, we'll talk about it. Let's go step by step. Let's not jump logical flow. Okay. Yeah, now many people, when they're dealing with matrices, okay, they think that the normal laws of matrices and the normal identity laws will work on that. For example, let's say if I say A plus B square, okay, when I ask people what is A plus B square, where A and B are matrices, they say, sir, A square plus 2AB plus B square. Please note that such laws will not work unless until AB is equal to BA. Okay? So unless until the matrix multiplication of A and B are commutative, please do not apply any binomial expansion formula on it. right? Are you getting my point? So in general, please do not write a plus b the whole square as a square plus 2ab plus b square. But if you know they are commutative, then only you can apply your binomial theorem property. So this is something which is very important. Please note it down. I'll write it over here. If AB is equal to BA, then binomial expansions can be applied to matrices. Okay. And especially if you're dealing with a square matrix and one of the other matrix is I, then you can definitely apply binomial expansion on that, because AI is equal to IA, A being a square matrix. We'll take some questions on that in a few minutes time. Okay. But let me just complete with this property. Then I'll come to that concept. Okay. So in general, if you say A plus B whole square, how do you write it? This is the way to write it. I'm running out of space over here. So if you say A plus B square, it is basically nothing but doing A plus B times A plus B. So ideally the result here is A square plus AB plus BA plus B square. So unless AB and BA are same, do not club it. Okay. So don't start using your normal identities on this. For example, if I say A plus B into A minus B, right? What's the result going to be? It's A square minus AB plus BA minus B square. So if AB is not equal to BA, don't cancel it out. They may be different matrices. Are you getting my point? So these are some common mistakes which people do. Next property. Matrix multiplication is distributive over addition or subtraction. Multiplication is distributive. Is distributive over addition and subtraction. Okay. What do I mean by this? So if I do A multiplied with B plus C, you can write it as AB plus AC. Or if I do A multiplied with B minus C, we can do AB minus AC. Okay. So these rules will, distributive rules will work on of multiplication over addition or subtraction. Okay. Now the fourth rule is slightly important. If you say product of A and B is null, okay, does it mean either one of them has to be null or both of them have to be null?
No.
Yes. So that is something very important. It does not imply that either A or B is null or both are null. Even if two non-null matrices multiply, they can give you a null as the answer. Okay, I'll give you an example here. So let's say A is a matrix like this, 0, minus 1, 0, 0. Okay, as you can see, it is not a null matrix. And let's say there's another matrix B, which is 1, 1, 0, 0. And you can see this is also not a null matrix. But when you multiply AB, you will all check it out that, follow this symbol. 0 into 1 is 0, minus 1 into 0 is 0. Similarly, first row, second column will give you a 0. Check it out. Second row, first column will give you a 0. Second row, second column will give you a 0. So answer is a null, even though both of them are not null. Okay. Now this has been a very frequent question in competitive exams, where they give a scenario like, if product of A and B is null, does it mean, you know, at least one of them should be null? The answer is no. Even if when both are not null, the answer can still be a null matrix. Is this fine? Okay. So inspired from this, basically, we have the cancellation laws. Oh my God, it's running out of space. So if I say AB is equal to AC, can I say B is equal to C? Can I say B is equal to C? The answer is no here. The answer is no here because of just now what we learned. So if product of two matrices is null, even if A is not null, it doesn't mean B minus C is null. That means it doesn't mean B may not be equal to C. Right? May not be equal to C. I'm not denying the fact that it will always be the case. No, it may not be. So it doesn't imply that, you know, either A is null or B is equal to C. Nothing like this. Okay. So basically, left cancellation law fails. Left cancellation fails. Okay. Same way, right cancellation will also fail. So if you say BA is equal to, let's say CA, it doesn't mean B is equal to C. It doesn't mean either A is null or B is equal to C. In fact, I should write here, it doesn't mean A is equal to null or B is equal to C. Because I've already put a negation sign over here. Okay. So be careful about that. So right cancellation fails. Right cancellation fails. Is this fine? Okay. Before we move on, we'll try to take up some questions on this because we have been doing theory for the last 1 hour or so. We'll take some questions. Okay, so we'll take up this question. Just try it out and let me know if you're done. The question is, if X is given to be 0, 1, 0, 0 square matrix of order 2, then prove that Pi plus Qx is given as, Pi plus Qx to the power of m is given as P to the power mi plus mp m minus 1 Qx for all P and Q belonging to real numbers. How do you prove such kind of questions? Have you done such kind of questions in your practice?
No.
Okay, not done. Okay, no worries. But can you try it now?
So can you use PMI?
Right. There are two ways to do it. One is by the use of PMI, other by the use of the properties that we discussed. Do you want me to solve it for you or would you like to try with PMI?
So we'll try.
Okay. Try it out with PMI. Now, multiplication is not a repeated addition anymore, Venkat. Here multiplication is transforming something. You are transforming a linear space by a transformation agent. That is the meaning of matrix multiplication.
Oh, okay, sir.
That's why we have to first overcome that feeling of applying normal number method, you know, rules to matrices.
Yes, sir. Same way we have to overcome putting angles in inverse.
That's absolutely correct. And especially you have been making that mistake quite a lot now.
Yes, sir.
See, Siddhartha, when I wrote a to the power n, I very clearly wrote n belongs to I plus. Correct? So, see, there are some operations which we normally entertain in the matrices. For example, square root can be found out for a square matrix. Okay? Inverse can be found out for a square matrix. But let's say if you do a complicated power, like, you know, raising it to a power of, you know, minus 5 or to the power of 5 by 6 and all, such operations are not entertained. So we don't raise a matrix to the power of 0. Okay, so such operations will not be entertained under matrices. We can raise it to either integer power, and there's one special symbol, but this is not an operation. It is just a, you can say it's a, you can, just like F inverse, it is a reserved symbol, no? F inverse is meaning, that means inverse of a function. In the same way, when you do A inverse, it is basically finding the inverse of that matrix. It is not to be treated as doing I by A or something. No, this is not. Even though your operation wise, it is A inverse is equal to I, but we don't reciprocate any matrix like this. There's no operation done like this. What the point?
But when we do a PMI, we first show that P of 1 is 2, right? Here, then you have to raise.
Then start with.
Oh, okay, okay. Sorry.
And this M is raised to the power of.
Yeah.
It is not on any matrix. It's not on any matrix, no? That's correct, Aditya. Okay, so let's say this statement is basically PM. Okay, PM states that PI plus QX to the power M is P to the power MI plus MP M minus 1 QX. So P1 states that PI plus QX is equal to P to the power 1I plus 1 into P to the power 0 QX, which is nothing but PI plus QX, which is definitely true. Which is definitely true. So therefore P1 is true. Okay. Now let us consider PN to be true. Let PN be true. Okay, that means you are taking this to be for granted. That means this expression is correct. I'm sorry, this will be N. Okay, now what I have to show my examiner that I have to show that, this is how you write it, I have to show that pi plus qx to the power of n plus 1 will be equal to p to the power n plus 1 I plus n plus 1 p to the power n qx. This is what you have to show. Okay. So now how do I show this? So we'll assume that this information is correct. So what I'll do is I'll multiply with pi plus qx on both the sides. So post facto multiplication will do. Doesn't matter even if you do pre facto with pi plus qx. Okay. So let's see what transformation happens. This into this will be p to the power n plus 1 I, no problem with that. This into this will give you p to the power n qx. This into this will give me.
Sir, p n plus 1 I square.
I square is I only.
Oh, okay. I.
Yeah. Yeah. So this into which one I was doing? This into this. Yeah. That will be n p to the power n. Okay. Qx. Now xi. See, I is basically the identity element as I told you. So ai and ia both are equal to a only. Okay. Provided a is a square matrix. A is a square matrix. So the last term would be, if I'm not mistaken, it will be n p n minus 1 q square x square, right? Now what is x square? If you figure out your x square, as Aditya rightly said, x square would come out to be null. Check it out. So row with column will give you zero. This with this will give you a zero. This with this will give you a zero. This with this will give you a zero. Okay. So what will happen? This will become a null matrix. This will become a null matrix. So basically, null matrix added to any matrix will give you the same result. So this will be the only thing that will be left off. By the way, if you take p to the power n qx common, n plus 1 will come out. This is what we wanted to prove. Which is your RHS. Okay. So you can conclude that Pn is true implies Pn plus 1 is true. And hence, by principle of mathematical induction, Pm will be true for n all m belonging to natural numbers. Okay. So these kind of questions, you can use your PMI. Now let's say I don't want to use PMI and solve it. How would I do that? So I'll tell you another method to do it. Method number 2. Copied this one. Can I move on to the next method?
Yes, sir.
Plus? Okay. Yes. Method number 2. See, when you do pi plus qx to the power of m, do you realize that in this case, let's say I call this as matrix A and I call this as matrix B. Do you realize that here commutative property will hold true? Do you agree with me or not? So if you do AB, what do you get? You get PQX. And if you do BA, it will become again PQX. No difference in the result. That means binomial expansions can be easily be applied to it without much problem. So if I apply a binomial expansion, it will become M. I hope you remember all your binomial expansion. MC1 PI to the power M minus 1 QX. Plus MC2 PI to the power M minus 2 QX square and so on and so forth. Okay. Now here you would realize an interesting thing as what Aditya had pointed out. X square will start becoming null, so any higher power of x will start becoming a null. Correct? So post this, everything will start becoming null, null, null. So your answer can only be obtained from the first two expressions, right? Is this fine? Any questions over here? So this will become p to the power m. Now I to the power m is like multiplying I to itself m number of times, which will result into an I. Okay, this will become m times p to the power m minus 1 I into qx. So that is nothing but p to the power m I plus m p to the power m minus 1 qx, which is your RHS. Is this fine? So how do we get from there to here? It's very simple. You are multiplying pi with pi with pi m number of times, right? And as I have told you in the scalar multiplication properties, you can actually collect all the scalars at one position. Okay. And I multiplied to itself any number of times is going to give you an I only. So this term is what is going to appear. I hope there's no doubt regarding that.
Sir, how did you determine AB is equal to BA?
How do you, this is your A and this is your B. If you multiply it, what do you get? You get PQX.
Okay, yeah.
BA will also be PQX.
Okay, got it. Correct. Yeah, understood, sir.
Okay. Now, something very interesting here. All of you, please pay attention. Sometimes we talk about matrix polynomials. Matrix polynomials. Okay, what is a matrix polynomial concept? Sometimes they will say this is your matrix A, find A cube plus 5A square plus 6A plus 7I. Have you come across such questions?
Yes, sir.
I'll give you an example. Let's say the question will speak like this. Let's say A is 2, 3, 5, let's say 9. Okay. Fine. They'll give you questions like this. Find A to the power 4, 5A cube, minus 7A square, plus 6A, plus 4I. 4I2. Okay. Of course, you're dealing with a 2 by 2. So these kind of questions are basically categorized as a matrix polynomial question. So basically, why it is called matrix polynomial? Because if you see, there's a polynomial you can make out of it like this. And it appears as if somebody is asking you to find FA. Okay. It appears as if somebody is asking you to find FA. Both of them are same things. Okay. So whether you do this or whether you do this, it means the same thing. Okay. Now here, what happens when such a question comes, people waste a lot of time, of course, doing these kind of multiplication. For example, here you will find A square first, correct? Because you need A square. Then you'll multiply again with an A to get A cube. Then probably you'll multiply A square with A square to get A to the power 4. And then do this, you know, collective addition subtraction job. That will kill a lot of time. Especially in JE kind of exam, we don't have so much of liberty to do these, you know, these tasks. It'll take a lot of time for you. Okay. So to overcome this, there is a very important method which is beyond your syllabus right now. The method is basically called as the Cayley-Hamilton theorem. Cayley-Hamilton theorem. Everybody, please listen to this very carefully. It is slightly difficult to understand in the first go. Okay, the proof of it, we are not going to talk about it because it is right now not in your scope. Okay, so I'm telling you something which is extra. Okay, so what is this Cayley-Hamilton theorem? Cayley-Hamilton theorem is a very simple theorem which says every square matrix satisfies its characteristic equation. Now, Now, I'm sure you would have not understood what is characteristic equation. Never mind. That's what I'm going to explain you now. What is the characteristic equation? What is this, by the way? Okay. And what do you mean when you say every square matrix satisfies its characteristic equation? Now, see, characteristic equation, I'm assuming everybody here knows basics of determinants. Not a very high funda determinant. Basics, you know, everybody? Anybody who doesn't know even ABC of determinant?
I don't, sir.
Who is that?
Dheeraj.
Dheeraj, you didn't do cross product of vectors in physics.
Okay, so that's determinants.
Yeah, that's determinants. Okay, I'll just tell you how it works. See, when you're evaluating determinant, let's say A, B, C, D, I'm just giving you a 2x2 example. You just cross multiply this, and subtract. Okay. This is how you evaluate the determinant. So determinant of this matrix gives you a number like this. At least this you know?
Yeah, that I know.
Okay. So characteristic equation of a matrix A is basically determinant of A minus XI equal to 0. Okay. So A, let's say I take my example here itself as my A, 2, 3, 5, 9. Okay. So what is A minus XI? So 2, 3, 5, 9. If I subtract X times I is basically 1, 0, 0, 1. By the way, even if I don't mention the order, please, it is up to you to take it of the same order as A. Okay, then only they will be confirmable to be added or subtracted. So this basically, if you write, it becomes 2 minus 3 x. Oh, I'm so sorry. 2 minus x, my bad. 3, 5, 9 minus x. Am I correct? Let me know if I missed out anything. Is this fine? Any problem in understanding A minus XI? X is something, I'll tell you what is X here. So basically to make an equation, you need a variable, right? So that is that variable X. Is this clear? Everybody's happy. Nobody's saying anything.
Clear, yes, sir.
Okay. Now, determinant of this. See, whatever I'm telling you, you will not find it in books. Okay, so please listen to this carefully. Determinant of this, put it to zero. That means 2 minus x times 9 minus x minus 15 equal to zero. Okay. If you simplify this, what do you get? Tell me. X square minus 11x
plus 3.
Plus 3. Okay. This equation is what I'm calling as the characteristic equation. So what does Cayley Hamilton say? Cayley and Hamilton were two mathematicians who have done a lot of work on the field of matrices. So these guys said that even A will satisfy this equation. That means even if you do A square minus 11A plus 3I, you will end up getting a null. So what do you do? Replace your x with a, and of course 3 will be replaced with 3i. 0 will be replaced with null. Okay, so this is what these guys told. If you don't trust me,
what are the names again, sir?
Cayley and Hamilton. Cayley Hamilton.
Oh, okay, sir.
I think they were Britishers. I'll just show you how it works. By the way, you would be now aware that you can apply GeoGebra, you can apply matrices concepts in GeoGebra also. So let's say, yeah, can somebody dictate me A? What was A?
2, 3, 5, 9.
Yeah, so this is how you write. Put a curly bracket, 2, comma 3 in one curly bracket, then put again a comma, then again put a curly bracket, 5, comma 9. So this is how it will come out, 2, 3, 5, 9. Okay. Now, what operation I said? A square, no? So A into A, it'll become A square minus, what did I say next?
11A.
11 times A
plus 3i.
Plus 3i. 3i, I let it like... Oh, by the way, you've already seen it as minus 3i coming up. So, 3i. I don't know whether I it has understood. Okay, anyways. I'll define I also. 1001. Yeah. So A square minus 11 A plus 3 I. Correct. What is this? Plus 11 A or minus 11 A?
Minus.
11 A plus 3 I. Yeah, as you can see, it is giving you null, correct? Isn't it? Now, if you know this, then your life becomes really very easy. So what do we do here? It is like finding the, you know, quotient and the remainder when this polynomial is divided by the characteristic equation. So what do we do in order to find this lengthy expression? The trick is you take the characteristic equation. If I'm not wrong, this is the characteristic equation, right? Plus 3. And you perform a long division with this particular, you know, polynomial matrix. So x to the power 4 plus 5x cube minus 7x square plus 6x plus 4. Okay, doing this is much more easier and convenient than actually putting those, you know, finding those matrices separately. So we'll do it very quickly. See, x square, it becomes x4 minus 11x cube plus 3x square. Subtract it. 16x cube minus 10x square plus 6x plus 4. Then again, you'll have 16x. So 16x cube. Oh my God, this is a very huge expression. 11 into 6 will be 176. 176x square plus 48x. Again, if you subtract, you get 166x square minus 42x plus 4. Then put a 166. So you'll have 166x square. Oh, yo, very, very big figure. What is this? 11 into 166. I hope I have not done any calculation mistakes anywhere. Just check. 1826 plus 1, sorry, minus 1826. Okay. And then this and this will become
198.
Okay. So if you subtract it, you finally get 17. How much is it? 1784, right? Okay. And this will become minus 494. Okay. So the trick here is that this expression, that is a to the power 4 plus 5a cube minus 7a square plus 6a plus 4i, was basically a square minus 11a plus 3i times this matrix, which is a square plus 16a plus 166i plus a remainder of this. Correct? So when you're evaluating this, this entire thing will go for a toss because this is a null matrix, correct? So your answer will just become 1784 times A minus 494i. That will become 1784 times, what was the matrix? 2359 minus 4941001. Are you getting my point? So if you evaluate this, you will be done with your answer. Actually, I took a very, very strange. I made it up myself. That's why the answers are quite ugly. Okay. But this is how you basically use Cayley-Hamilton theorem to solve matrix polynomial questions like this. Now, again, not to be used in school. Only to be used in competitive exams. Any questions here, anybody?
So can you scroll down?
Yeah, sure.
So one more example could be
different. Yeah, I'll give you one more example. In fact, we'll solve a question on this.
Well, the same thing would be applicable to 3x3 matrix also, sir.
Yes. Any square matrix, whether it's 3x3, 4x4, 5x5.
Sir, is it possible to obtain a characteristic equation of higher power than the polynomial equation?
I'm sorry?
Sir, is it possible? What if we obtain a characteristic equation of higher power than the polynomial equation?
If you obtain a higher power from the polynomial equation, then see, let's say if somebody had asked you a single degree, okay, then basically you can do this. Then you have to find A inverse and all, because now I'll tell you some hidden advantages of this. So when you write it like this, and let's say A is invertible, okay, let's say A is invertible, then you can also write it like this. Okay, but that process will lead to you finding inverse of that matrix. In the reverse case, basically we use it to find inverse also. So Cayley-Hamilton theorem not only helps you to find matrix polynomials, but also helps us to find the inverse of a matrix. I'm sure you would have done inverse of a matrix in the later stage of this chapter. So you can use Cayley-Hamilton to solve the inverse. For example, if let's say this can help me to find inverse of this by using the formula 11i minus a 1/3 of it. Okay, then you don't have to find those. How many methods you have learned to find the inverse of a matrix?
Two, sir.
At least two. Correct. This is the third method. But provided it is invertible. Okay, so you have to check first for its non-singularity, and then you can apply this Cayley-Hamilton theorem to get the inverse. So to answer your question, I think it was Ayush who asked it.
Vibhav.
So Vibhav, if you have a lower degree, then probably have to work, this method would not be that great a method. Then you probably can use your direct multiplication and addition, because that is easy for you to take care. Why you want to pick up a hammer to break an egg when you can do it with a spoon? Okay. So it is mostly used when you have a very heavy degree polynomial in matrices. Okay. Now a couple of things before I move on, which are very important. Number one, I don't know where to write. Okay, I'll write it over here. So some important properties of characteristic equation. Properties of characteristic equation. Number one, the sum of the roots of the characteristic equation. First of all, let me just name something here. The roots of the characteristic equation are called eigenvalues. Okay, eigen or eigen, whatever you want to perform it, call it. It is called eigen or eigenvalues. Okay. The main use of it is in formulating eigenvectors. Okay. Now, what is eigenvectors used for? You learn later on, it is used for the process of diagonalization of matrices. Anyways, that is not going to be a part of your at least JE syllabus. So I'm not going to talk about it. Just for your information, you should know it. Okay. The roots of the characteristic equation are basically called eigenvalues. Now, second property is, the sum of the roots, let's say my eigenvalues are lambda 1, lambda 2, etc. till lambda n. That depends upon what is the order of A. Okay, if A is a square matrix of order n, the characteristic equation will also be an order n equation or degree n equation. Okay, as you can see here, we had a second degree equation over here because A was second degree. Okay. If you have a third degree, A will become if A is order 3, then characteristic equation will be of degree 3. Okay. So if let's say you're dealing with a square matrix of order n, then you will get a characteristic equation of degree n, which will have, let's say, these n eigenvalues. The sum of the eigenvalues, okay, that is nothing but lambda 1 plus lambda 2 till lambda n, will be equal to the trace of that given matrix. Now you can check this out from the given workout that we have done. So if, let's say, there were two roots over here, lambda 1 and lambda 2, what is the sum of lambda 1 and lambda 2? If, let's say, these are the 11. Roots, the root is, yeah, sum is minus
11.
11. Now just add the leading diagonal elements of A.
Oh.
You'll get 11. Okay. This property is always true. Okay.
Why, sir?
Again, don't ask me the proof, because this is something which you have to go inside eigenvalues, you know, all those proofs you have to see. What did actually Cayley-Hamilton theorem found out from that proof? It is just a, you know, working model which I want to explain you, so that you can, you know, make your life easy in your competitive exams. Third thing that you will figure out is that product of the eigenvalues, that is nothing but lambda 1, lambda 2 till lambda n, will be actually the determinant of A. Okay. Now, it's not that you cannot find this out. If you generally take a matrix A, B, C, D, you will come to know that, you know, at this position, normally you will get A plus C. To answer your question, Venkat.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So if you perform this operation in general, you would realize that, see, I just do this operation in general. A, B, C, D, if let's say this was your matrix A. Okay. And let's say I found out the characteristic equation. I'm just writing that down, the characteristic equation, without doing any background work. Characteristic equation would be, what would be? A minus X times D minus X minus BC equal to zero. This is your characteristic equation. If you open this up, don't you see A plus D coming in the coefficient of X? And don't you see AD minus BC coming up here? So this shows that the leading diagonals will always be the sum of the roots of the characteristic equation. And this will be nothing but the determinant of this matrix. So this is nothing but the trace of the matrix. This is nothing but the determinant. Now you can scale this up to 3 by 3, 4 by 4 and all. So that generic proof I am not going to talk about here. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Next important property, which is most important one. If lambda 1, lambda 2 till lambda n are the eigenvalues of A, okay, then if you subject A to any positive integer power, even these roots are going to experience the same powers. Let me write K. I always write n as the power, least realizing that n was also the degree, order of that matrix. So let me write K. Okay, so these will be the eigenvalues of A to the power K, okay? Where K can be either a positive integer or it could be a minus 1. Now, minus 1 means, even if you're reciprocating, take my word reciprocating to be literal, even if you're inverting that matrix, or even if you're taking the inverse of that matrix, then the eigenvalues of the characteristic equation of the inverse of that matrix will be the reciprocals of the eigenvectors of A, eigenvalues of A. So let's say, if you find out the roots here, okay, let's say if you find out the roots here, whatever they may be, if you find out the eigenvalues of A inverse, you will find that the roots of that characteristic equation would be reciprocals of the roots of this equation. That is what the last property says. Are you getting my point? So if I square this matrix and try to find its characteristic equation, and from there I try to find out its eigenvalues, I can directly say that the eigenvalues would be the square of the corresponding roots of the eigenvalues of A. Okay, so read this again. If A has lambda 1, lambda 2 till lambda n as the eigenvalues, then A to the power k will have lambda 1 to the power k, lambda 2 to the power k till lambda n to the power k as the eigenvalues, provided k is a positive integer, or it is also applicable to inverse of A. By the way,
the eigenvalues have...
Sorry?
So do the eigenvalues have to be real, or they can be imaginary also?
They will be real.
They'll always be real, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
They will be real. Okay. What type of questions can you get on this? Of course, one involving polynomial in matrices. So I'll try to take a question on this. Yeah, these type of questions are very irritating because it makes you find a cube, a square, and do those operations. So such questions can be easily dealt with eigen characteristic equation concept. So to answer your question, Tripan, if your entries of the matrices are real, eigenvalues will be real. But if they are complex, which we'll see today itself, like you can have a matrix with complex numbers as entries of that matrix, then it can be non-real also.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Any success with this?
One minute, sir.
Can I run a poll?
Yes.
Yeah. So those who have answered, please press on the poll. Let's see. Can we close this in another 30 seconds? 13 of you have responded so far on the poll.
Just a second, sir.
Okay, last 10 seconds, everybody please vote. At the count of 5, now I'll stop. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, everyone. 9 of you still not voted. Okay. So, maximum Janta has gone with option B. Okay, let's see B is correct or not. See, quickly make a characteristic equation out of it. A minus xi determinant is 0. Now, there's a way to write A minus xi also fast. Only the elements in the diagonal position subtract x from it like this. Okay, rest all the elements you copy as such. Okay. Let us expand this with respect to the first row. So 1 minus x times, this is going to be x square minus 2x minus 1, if I'm not mistaken. Then minus 1. Acha, people are aware of the expansion of a 3 by 3? Who doesn't know? Who doesn't know how to expand 3 by 3? Everybody knows it, right?
I don't, sir. Dheeraj.
Dheeraj, see, Dheeraj, what do we do is, I'll tell you how to expand with respect to one of the rows. Let's say row number 1. Just take this element. Okay, write it down over here. Okay. Then hide the row and the column to which that falls. So you'll see these four elements left out, right? So just put your finger on the first column and first row. You'll see these four elements left, right? Then cross multiply and subtract it.
Okay.
Then okay. Next element, write 1, but put a negative sign in front of it. So it basically alternates plus, minus, plus, like that. Okay. So write a minus 1, hide the column and the row to which it belongs. Now cross multiply these two, which is minus x, cross multiply these two, which is 2, and subtract it. Okay.
Got it, sir. Thanks.
So this is done. Now 0 is not to be taken into account, so that will be 0. Now, determinant expansion is only done with respect to any one row or any one column, okay, of your choice. You could choose any row or any column of your choice. Okay, so if you expand this, what do we get? Let me be slightly quick here. Okay, some things may cancel out. For example, x cube will feature in. Okay, minus x cube will feature in. I think x square and x square will be 3x square. So let me just strike off whatever I'm taking care of, okay, so that I have a track of it. So minus x and plus 1. Okay, have I done it correctly? Just verify.
Plus 2.
I'm so sorry. This is plus x. So this and this will. Wait. 1 second. This will become plus x plus 2, correct? So this will become x square minus x minus 1 minus x cube plus 2x square plus x. That's correct. Okay. Oh, x will cancel out. There will be no x only. My bad. Old age problems. Okay. So now this will become, now this is the characteristic equation. Now matrix A will satisfy its characteristic equation. So you'll say minus A cube plus 3A square plus 2I will be null. I think if you can just take the negative sign everywhere. Oh my bad, there's a minus one over here. Plus one. Okay, so now this is going to be your final result. I think option B is what is matching with it, right? By the way, this is not zero. It's actually null. Even there is null actually. Okay, it's not a zero. Matrices will give you null matrices as the answer. Okay, so option number B is the right option. Okay. Do you find that this method is more convenient than actually finding a cube and a square and all those stuff?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sorry.
Sir.
Yeah. But unfortunately, not to be used in school. Sorry. Okay. Let's take another question. Actually, there are so many questions I would like to do with you, but I have to pick them out. Just bear with me. This is one we did. Yeah. ITJE 2005. A is given, I3 is given. I don't know why they have given I3. Even if they have not given, we would have figured it out. And they're saying A inverse is this. Find C and D values. Let me put the poll on once again, okay?
I'm not able to see the poll.
Is it?
Sir, I can see it.
I minimized it.
Yeah, after you minimize it, I don't think you can get it.
Oh, it's down in the taskbar.
Oh, yeah.
One person has answered after 2 minutes of hard work. Why you want to go to that extent, Aditya? No cofactor and all is required. See, if you go by that cofactor route, basically you're finding adjoint. Then you have to find determinant. Then you have to find a square. You have to do this operation. Compare the terms. Oh my goodness. If you're going to solve it in that way, I better quit this question and go to the next one. JE is not testing your conventional thinking approach. Conventional thinking, anybody can solve it. If I give 10 minutes to somebody, he will easily be able to solve this question. Okay, in another 30 seconds, I'm going to close the poll. Another 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Half the people have only voted. Come on, class, come on. Okay, yeah, so Janta is saying C option. Okay, let's see whether Janta is Janadan or not. See, characteristic equation quickly. Let's not waste time. When you know the stuff, you should not waste time. Okay. Okay. Expand with respect to the first row. So 1 minus x, 1 minus x, 4 minus x, plus 2. Nothing else you have to do. This is your characteristic equation. Correct. Of course, you have to expand it once more. If I'm not mistaken, it will be x square minus 5x plus 4 plus 2 is plus 6. Okay, keep correcting me if I miss out something. Okay, so now if I expand it, if I'm not mistaken, I'll get x square minus 5x plus 6 minus x cube plus 5x square minus 6x is equal to 0. Minus x cube term, x square term will be 6x square. Gone. Minus 11x, gone, 6 equal to 0, okay? That means your characteristic equation is a cube minus 6a square plus 11a plus 6i equal to O. Got the point? Now, as I told you, while I was dealing with characteristic equation not only helps you to, you know, get the polynomial, matrix polynomial question correct,
but minus.
See, I told you. Yeah. Okay. So multiply with A inverse. Now, provided A inverse exists. Now, how do you know whether A inverse exists? If the determinant here is non-zero, A inverse will exist. As you can see, determinant here would be 4 plus 2, 6, non-zero. Okay. So A inverse exists. So for that, multiply throughout with A inverse. That means reduce 1 power each. This guy will become 11i. This guy will become minus 6a inverse. Take it to the other side. A inverse will be 1/6 of. Correct me if I'm wrong. That means your answer is C is 6. Minus 6, my bad. D is 11. So minus 6, 11 is your answer. Option number C. Can you beat this method? I don't think so. Any other method will take you double the time at least. Okay. So say thanks to Kaylee and Hamilton. You can say to me also, no problem. Okay, let's take a break now. On the other side of the break, we'll talk about, you know, transpose of a matrix and other special matrices like idempotent, involutory, orthogonal, all those stuff. Let's have a break.
Sir, could you scroll down?
Is this fine enough?
Yes, sir.
So let's have a break.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Question?
Yes, sir. Could you go back?
Are you, some people are copying this, right?
Yeah, after that only. That's what I meant, sir. are faint.
Go back means go to the previous slide.
Yes, sir.
People who are copying this?
Done, sir. 1 second, sir. Okay, done.
Now this method, you will not find it in books also. So please don't expect this to read out from some books. These all are engineering stuffs. So I once upon happened to do engineering. So there I learned this. Yeah, Venkat, this is the page?
No, sir. The previous one where you discuss is Kelly.
Kelly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Kelly, sir. Kelly. This one?
Yes, sir. Left, sir. Left down. Third quadrant.
Left down. Here.
Yes, sir. So what exactly did you do after finding out the characteristic, like that polynomial relation? I didn't understand.
This you got?
Yeah, I understood.
You replace your x with a and a constant with I, 3i, constant I. That's what we do.
Yeah, that was understood, sir.
Yeah. So now this is always, you know, null, no? So anything multiplied yes, will also be null. Correct.
Yeah.
Okay. And from here also you can multiply with A inverse also, no? So A inverse will give you A inverse A will become I. I A inverse will become A inverse. So I can find A inverse also from this.
Oh, okay. No, sir, not this one, the actual polynomial thing. You divided null, no? That uh-huh. Is.
So basically, I treated it as a polynomial. So basically, how do you write dividend as quotient times divisor plus remainder?
Oh, okay.
Right. I did the same thing. So I treated this as the dividend. Okay. This is my divisor. This is my quotient. And this is my remainder.
Yes, sir.
So since divisor itself is null, this whole thing will be null, no?
Yeah.
And only this thing has to be found out. So for finding this big thing, you can just evaluate this thing.
Oh, okay.
You don't have
okay.
to square anything. You can just deal with A and I only. That's it.
Okay, yes, sir.
So?
And you obtained that biquadratic on your own, no, sir? Just multiply two random things to give that two factors.
No, this is a long division method.
No, the actual biquadratic.
This I made up on my own. Yeah, sorry. I made up this on my own. Yeah, Anjali.
So till when do we have break?
One second. Break has been declared. Okay, one second. So 6:29 we can meet. Is this fine? So now on the operations, basically we have learned addition, we have learned a scalar multiplication, we have learned how to multiply matrices, and we have also learned how to find answers to matrix polynomials by the use of Cayley-Hamilton theorem. Now we have been equipped with enough knowledge now to now talk about special types of matrices. But before that, I would just like to talk a bit about transpose of a matrix. Transpose of a matrix. Okay. So let's say there's a matrix A, which is basically a M cross N order matrix, right? When we say transpose of this matrix, basically what do? By the way, representation is A to the power T. In fact, A superscript T, I'll not say to the power. or A dash, many people write it. It is basically switching the position of, it is switching the position of the rows and the columns, or swapping the positions of the rows and the columns. Okay. So when you do transpose, what do? You send the element in the ijth position to ijith position. Okay. And as a result, you'll see the order will become from m cross n to n cross m. A simple example for the same is, let's say we have a matrix A, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Then its transpose would be written as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you can see a 2 by 3 matrix has now become a 3 by 2. Now, let's say this element, if I talk about, it was present in the first row's third column. So this is basically A1, 3 element, first row, third column. It has now come to A3, 1 position. So that is what is meant by this. Okay. Now, some properties of transpose, because these properties are going to be very important later on. So everybody please pay attention to these properties. Properties of transpose of a matrix. Transpose of a matrix. First property is, if you transpose a matrix twice, it'll give you the same matrix back, which is very evident. So A transpose transpose will give you the same matrix back. Okay. If you transpose the sum or difference of two matrices, it is as good as taking the sum or difference of their transposes. Okay. If you transpose product of two matrices, it follows law of reversal. Okay, this is called the law of reversal. Okay, so this was, I think, the question that somebody was asking me early in the class today. Okay, and this can be extended to any number of, you know, matrices. Let's say A, B, C transpose. Then basically you'll transpose it from the reverse direction. So it'll be C transpose, B transpose, A transpose. Is this fine? Okay. This is one of the most important properties that we'll be exploiting for, you know, subsequent concepts coming up in matrices. Next property is, if a scalar multiplication of a matrix is transposed, there is no effect on the scalar term. Okay, don't start transposing a scalar number. There is nothing called transpose of a scalar number. Okay. So KA transpose is K times A transpose. Similarly, if you are raising any square matrix, A is a square matrix. Let's say A is a square matrix. And if you're raising it to any positive integer power and you're taking a transpose of it, it is as good as raising the transpose of that matrix to the same positive integer power. This is also applicable to inverse also. Later on, we'll learn about this. So A inverse transpose is A transpose inverse. There's no difference in this. But many don't treat inverse as a power. Okay. This is not a power. This is just a symbol. It is just a symbolic thing. A inverse means inverse of the matrix A. Next property is, there is no change in the trace. There is no change in the trace even if you transpose the matrix. Okay. And you learn later on also, there is no change in the determinant value also. Okay, but I'll not write it down over here. We'll talk about it when we do a determinant properties. Trace of a product of a matrix with its transpose. Okay. Of course, A should be a square matrix over here. Okay, this will always be greater than equal to 0. By the way, A into A transpose will always result into a square matrix. So this will by default be a square matrix. Why it happens to be greater than equal to 0? Because the elements in the leading diagonal will all be perfect squares. Okay. Now, with this knowledge, we are now going to jump to some special matrices. There you would realize how important these properties are. Okay.
So, 1 second, sir.
Yeah.
So, could you scroll up a second?
Yeah, sure. Done. People who are copying, are you done with it? Yeah, okay. So I'm now going to the next page. Here we'll talk about some special matrices. Some questions have been asked in GE on these special matrices. Okay, so let's be aware of them. The first I'm going to start with is idempotent matrix. Okay, what are idempotent matrices? So first of all, idempotent matrices are square matrices. So these are square matrices. Okay, which satisfies this property that A square will be equal to A. Okay, now this is the fundamental property, but you'll realize that if you raise it to any power, okay, that will actually giving you A only. For example, if I do a cube, okay, won't it be a square into a, and a square is again an a, so a into a is again a square, which is back to a, right? Correct. So if I raise it to a power 4, that means basically you're doing a square square, that is again a square, that is again a, correct? So the idea is idempotent matrix, even they say a square is a, it is basically a raised to the any power, of course n should be positive integer. That will be A itself. Okay. An example of the same would be, let's say I take an example. Let's say 2, 2, minus 1, minus 1. Okay. If you do A square, you can just do this operation very easily at your end also. So take this row, multiply with this, it will become 2 only. This with this will become again a 2. This with this will become minus 1. And this will become again a minus 1. So you're back to A only. Okay. So this is a typical example of an idempotent matrix. Now, few properties that we need to know about idempotent matrix. Remember, NCRT or your basic books of your school level, they don't cater to these special matrices, do they? Okay.
Don't know, sir.
Sorry?
Not there,
no? Okay. Now, this property is basically treat them as a prove that question, okay? If A and B are idempotent matrices, if A and B are idempotent matrices, okay, then AB is idempotent if and only if AB is equal to BA. Can you prove it? Only when A and B's multiplication is commutative, then you can say that AB will be idempotent, provided A and B themselves are idempotent. Let me know once you're done. See, A and B are idempotent means what? A square is A, B square is B. Okay, primarily this is what we mean by A and B being idempotent. So if you want AB to be idempotent, what does it mean? It means you're saying AB square should be equal to AB. Now, what is the meaning of AB square? AB square means AB times AB. Okay, so we have to prove this. Okay, this is what we have to prove. So now let us start with the LHS. LHS is AB whole square. AB whole square is AB into AB. Correct. So this is nothing but A BA into B. Correct. Now if you want your result to come out to be AB and you have to use this property, then only this will become AB again. Then only it will become A square B square. And then again, from these two properties, you can say this is A and B. So unless until this is true, you will be stuck at this step. So because this was true, then only you could proceed further and write it like this, and then this finally. So if you want AB to be idempotent, it can only happen when you break this bottleneck or you break this hindrance point over here. That is, you consider your BA and AB to be the same. That means you honor this condition, then only you can proceed further and get a AB. Are you getting my point? Next property. Can I?
So one second, I'll just copy this down.
Yeah.
So can you explain why AB will be equal to BA?
No, I'm not saying why AB will be equal. I'm saying that if this condition is not true, no, then it is not going to be idempotent. So only when this condition supports it, then only AB will be an idempotent matrix. See, what does the property say? Property says if A and B are idempotent, then AB will be idempotent if and only if AB is equal to BA. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So what I'm doing here is I'm basically starting from the fact that if AB is an idempotent matrix and if this condition is not true, then you will be stuck at this step. You can't move any further. So since AB and BA are equal, without that it will not be idempotent. So I have considered AB as BA. Or in fact, BA as AB, and then I proceeded to get my final result. Okay. So the question in the exam can be placed like this. If A and B are idempotent and AB is also idempotent, then which of the following option is true? In that, one of the option will be AB is equal to BA. That option you have to mark. Getting my point now? Second property. If A and B are idempotent, okay, then A plus B will be idempotent if and only if AB is equal to BA is equal to a null matrix. Now, this is very easy to prove. So, if A and B are idempotent, means you are saying A square is A and B square is B. Okay. Secondly, if you are saying A plus B is idempotent, that means you are claiming this. Okay, let's see what happens when you go next. So when you do this, it becomes A square plus BA plus AB plus B square on the left hand side. Sorry, B square. Okay, on the right hand side, you are saying A plus B. Okay, what does it mean? It means BA plus AB is going to be, now cancellation law, apply cancellation law, so null will be left, correct? Yes or no? So can I say when this condition is true, then both of them will be null null? But why both of them have to be null?
So if one is not null, then obviously A plus B whole square won't be A plus B.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
So if BA is null and AB is not null, then you have A plus B whole square as A square plus B square plus AB.
Okay.
So we'll still have an AB term. So.
That was not very clear. Why? I mean, this sum could be null. Why individually they have to be null? That is my question.
Otherwise, if one is not null and the other is null, then how can they be idempotent in the first place?
I didn't get you.
It's like saying a non-zero number equals to zero. If you want, if that means idempotent thingy won't be satisfied there.
Athar was an answer. No, Athar, my question is, I could have the sum as null, but not individually. So let's say this was a matrix X and this could have been a minus X. Okay. Why X has to be null, null each? That is what I'm asking you.
And odd power thing is also there.
Sorry?
Odd power problem.
What odd power? Is my question clear to all of you?
So if they both are not null, then they can't be negative of each other, I think. Like AB can't be equal to minus BA. I don't know how to prove it, but that may be the answer.
Okay, think about it and let me know. Some of you have given the right argument. You just have to properly phrase your sentences. Okay, next question is, our next property, so as to say, is if AB is equal to A and BA is equal to B, okay, then A and B are idempotent. This question can come in your competitive exams. Sorry, idempotent. Yeah. Can you prove this? If AB is equal to A and BA is equal to B, it means A and B are idempotent. So using this, you have to prove that A square will be A and B square will be B. Done. Isn't this very simple? If you do, if you take AB is equal to A, and, yeah, and multiply with a AB, let's say. Okay. So can I say, yeah, can I say here, this AB could be written as A, correct? Sorry, this AB could be written as A, and A into A could be written as A square. And this AB itself is A. I'll repeat once again. See, let me start with this. We know AB is equal to A. We know AB is equal to A. Correct? If you multiply with a post facto, this will become A square. Correct? Yes or no? And this BA, you can write it with a B. And AB is again an A. So you can write this as this. That means you prove this statement. Right? So A has to be idempotent. Similarly, if you start with a B, A is equal to B. Okay. Multiply with a B. Then this AB could be written as an A. And this BA is again a B, which means B is an idempotent matrix.
So A is equal to B.
Huh?
Yeah, when we do that, it'll become A is equal to B. Because in that first case, if we multiply by B,
okay,
then we'll get B A S B.
Which so one? A, which one you are saying? The first part. This part.
Yes.
Okay. So A B. If you are multiplying with a B, what will happen?
Yeah. Then you take B A S.
You multiply pre facto or post facto.
Pre facto.
Means B here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Fine. Yeah.
So A need not be equal to B, right? Was that Sahana? Sahana? Or Ananya?
Ananya.
Ananya. So A need not be equal to B. Why should A be equal to B?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Okay, so next property is, if A is idempotent, if A is idempotent, okay, determinant of A could either be 0 or 1. Now, this is something which would require you to know your determinant's properties also. So I don't know how many of you know this property. If A and B are square matrices, if A and B are square matrices, okay, then determinant of AB is determinant of A into determinant of B. Are you aware of this property? This is a very, very important property in determinants. Okay. So if you're saying A square is A, right? Basically, you're trying to say this. So basically, you're trying to say this. So from this property, you can say this is determinant A into determinant A is equal to determinant A, right? That means determinant A square is equal to determinant A. Okay, so this can imply two things: either determinant A is 1 or it is 0. Okay, so for any idempotent matrix, your determinant will either be 0 or 1. I think you can test the example which I have given you. As you can see, here the determinant is going to be 0. Fine. Any questions here, anybody?
So could you go to the
here?
No, down. So.
Down. Yeah, this is the lowest I can go.
Yes, just a second. Thank you, sir.
Next, we'll come back to problems on these once we have completed all the special matrices, because normally they all come together in a problem. Next is involutory matrix. The word itself means self-inverse, right? So a square matrix A is said to be involutory if A is its own inverse. In other words, A square is I. Okay, so two things that we need to take care, that it should be a square matrix. In fact, all the special matrices that we are going to talk about, they will be square matrices only. And second thing is, its square should be identity matrix. Now you would realize here that from this property, it is evident that when your A is raised to any even power, okay, it'll always give you an identity matrix. Okay. And when A is raised to an odd power, it'll always give you an A. I hope it is very clear from this property. Correct? So if you see A cube, it will be this into A. So that will generate an A. But if you do A4, it'll again become an I. So in an involutory matrix, whenever you raise the matrix to a even index or even power, it will give you I, but if you raise it to an odd index, it will give you A itself. An example of this can be, let's say -5, -8, 3, 5. Okay, just try squaring it. So this will be 25 minus 24, 1. This will be minus 40 plus 40, 0. This will be 15 minus 15, 0. This will be 24 plus 20, minus 24 plus 25, 1. Okay. One important thing that you need to note here is determinant of a involutory matrix will either be 1 or a minus 1. It again comes from the same fact. So from here, if you do determinant A square, it will be determinant of I. Determinant of I is 1, and this is determinant A square. So this will give you two results, plus or minus 1. You can check here, in this case, the result is minus 1, right? Check the determinant here, it will be minus 1. Other way around is not true. Okay, so don't think like, oh, determinant is 1, so it has to be an involutory matrix. No, other way around is not true. If it is an involutory matrix, the determinant will be plus minus 1. Same with the, you know, idempotent also. If it is an idempotent matrix, then the determinant will be 0 or 1. But vice versa is not true. Is this fine? Any questions here?
Sir, I had it out in the previous slide, actually.
Previous slide? In the idempotent?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, in those cases where we were multiplying by A or multiplying by B, if A or B were null matrices, then we couldn't have done that, sir.
A and B were?
if either of A or when we were multiplying by A or multiplying by B, if either A or B were null matrices, then we couldn't have done that, no sir.
No, but see, in the idempotent matrix, we normally null matrix are by default the idempotent matrix. That is agreed. No problem with that. But why won't we do that in the case of a null in this case? Null, is
sir,
null,
I didn't get.
Is null an exception?
Sir, it's idempotent.
Null is an idempotent. That is fine. What is idempotent? Square of it will be the same matrix, right?
Yes, sir.
So why won't it work in this case? You can't multiply
sir, because null. Sir, when we multiply by null, then it's like we're multiplying both sides by zero, no, sir.
But this property is getting true, right? So A will be null. So null is equal to null square. That is correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Right. So that is a special case, but it still satisfies it. It is no exception to this case, right?
Yes, sir.
Correct, no? Yeah. So, yeah, any other question?
Sir, I had a doubt. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, can a matrix be idempotent and involutory?
Can a matrix be idempotent and involutory? Let me check. I is such a matrix, right?
Okay, yes, sir.
Yeah, because I square is I and it is the same matrix itself, right? So, yeah, it can be involutory, yes, and idempotent at the same time. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Next is nilpotent. Nilpotent. So, this is also a square matrix. This is also a square matrix, let's say A. So when a matrix basically gives you this property, A to the power m is null, but A to the power m minus 1 is not a null, then we say it is a nilpotent matrix of index, this is called nilpotent matrix of index m. Matrix of index m. For example, let's say if you take a matrix, okay, if you square it, for let's say it's a not a null matrix, if you square it, okay, it doesn't give you null. If you cube it, it doesn't give you null, but if you raise it to the power 4, it starts giving you null. Then we'll say that this is a nilpotent matrix. Then A is a nilpotent matrix of index 4. Okay, nilpotent matrix of index 4.
Sir, could you just repeat this? I didn't understand clearly.
Let's say there's a matrix A, which is a square matrix, which is not a null matrix. Okay, if you squared it, it gave you a non-null. If you cube it, it gave you a non-null. If you raise it to a power 4, then started giving you null. In that case, A will be a nilpotent matrix of index 4.
Okay.
Right. I'll give you an example on this. Let's say if you have a matrix like this, AB, B square minus A square minus AB. Okay. Right now, let's say it is not a null matrix. Let's say A and B are non-zero quantities. Okay. Try doing A square. What do you get? A square is basically this into this. Okay. So AB square minus AB square 0. AB cube minus AB cube 0. Then minus A cube B minus plus A cube B 0. And minus A square B square plus A square B square 0, right? So basically we'll say that this is a nilpotent matrix of index
2.
Matrix of index 2. Okay. So the least positive power for which it starts giving you null, that will be called as the index. Now note that after a to the power 4 in the previous example, hypothetical example which I took, it will be 0, 0, 0 or null, 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 right? So the least power for which it starts giving you null, that is called the index of that nilpotent matrix.
So can it have a not null value after the few indexes?
No. It won't. Moment one null has come, it will be null only.
Null
into any square matrix will be null only. Correct?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So how exactly does it work?
So 1 second, could you show the example?
Yeah. So basically, if A is a nilpotent of index M, nilpotent of index M, then a to the power n will be null if n is greater than or equal to m. This is to answer your question, Anjali. So any higher order, higher index, if you take, it will give you null only.
Yes.
Is it fine? Okay, another important thing is, can you comment anything about the determinant of a nilpotent matrix?
Zero?
Will it always be zero?
No, sir.
I'm not able
to. How exactly does this nilpotent matrix work? Like, why exactly does it work the way it is?
I told you, this worked in this way that after a certain value, which is called the index, its determinant starts, its value starts becoming null.
Yes, sir. Like, but why does it work the way it does? Like, there's some graph or something for this.
See, it says that if you apply that transformation repeatedly, okay, then that transformation will collapse the R2 space or whatever space it is working on to a point, to a null space. Okay. This requires your understanding of linear algebra a bit. See, when you are multiplying a matrix with itself, basically you are imposing one transformation on the other. See, remember in the beginning of the class I gave you.
Oh yeah, increase in dimensions.
Right. If let's say if I apply one more multiplication on this, let's say one, two, three, four. What does it mean? It means there are two transformations which are working together. So this will be a combined transformation, you can say, let's say T. Are you getting my point? So it is like, let's say I give you an example that I showed my daughter's image, right?
Yes,
I reflected it about the X axis. Let's say I then reflected about the Y axis. Then I ask you, tell me a transformation which will directly result into that. Then that would be the product of those two transformations. Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Get the motive behind why we are learning these matrices. Matrix multiplication is basically trying to do multiple transformations and see what transformation will equivalently replace that transformation. Right? Let's take the same situation. Let's say this was my daughter's photograph. Okay. If you want to reflect it about the y-axis, what transformation we used?
Replace x with a minus x.
So what did we do that? Minus 1, 0, 0, 1? Correct?
Yes, sir.
Let's say whatever image comes here, I want to reflect it again about the x-axis. What transformation will you use?
Minus 1, 0, 0, minus 1.
You'll use 1, 0, 0, -1, correct?
Oh, from the first thing, okay.
Now, the transformation which directly brings from this position to this position will be nothing but T2, T1. So, just multiply these two. See what will happen. So, 1, 0, 0, -1 multiplied to -1, 0, 0, 1. See what will happen. It will become a -1, check. This will become a 0. This will again become a 0. And this will become a -1. See what has happened. If any pixel has a position vector xy, it will result into -x, -y, showing that it is jumping straight away from the first quadrant to the third, and vice versa.
Sir, we have to multiply them in the opposite order.
Yes. So if you're doing transformation T1, then T2, then T3, then T4, then the multiplication will be T4, T3, T2, T1, like that.
Yes, sir.
So try to understand, matrix multiplication is basically applying multiple transformations and trying to produce a single transformation which produces the same act. Now are you getting the point? So how do you express this in terms of a graph or something? I have no clue about that. But this is how I understood my matrices. I don't know how you plot a graph of a matrix. I don't know that. They are just agents to make transformations of space.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah. Any other question anybody has? Okay. So think about it and let me know. Think about it and let me know. What can you comment about the determinant of a nilpotent matrix?
Sir?
Yeah.
So I think I got the answer to the question you asked before about the idempotent matrix.
What was the question I asked?
So you asked why A, B and B should individually...
Tell me what is the answer.
So I think if... So you get A plus B whole square will be A square plus B square plus AB plus BA.
Correct.
So if you multiply I to AB plus BA whole, it's going to remain the same. And I is A into A inverse. So you will get ABA plus BA square. So could you write it down?
Sure. Yeah, my question was, if A plus B whole square is equal to A plus B, okay, then we got from here A square plus B square plus AB plus BA, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay.
So, yes. So if you combine AB plus BA and multiply it with I.
Okay, so now this becomes A plus B. Okay, and now this should be a null matrix, correct?
Yes, sir. So it's like A plus AB plus BA whole multiplied with I.
Do I write this or should I not write this?
Sir, it doesn't matter.
Okay, I'll not write this. Okay, then. Okay.
Yeah, so I is A into A inverse.
Okay.
So if you multiply A with, I think, distributive property, then you'll get A square B plus ABA.
You'll get...
A inverse will be outside.
A inverse is outside and introducing A inside.
Yeah.
So that means you should have multiplied with A inverse.
Yes, I took it to the right. Okay.
So if you write A inverse A and if you open the bracket, it becomes A square B plus A inverse.
So A inverse will be outside.
Okay. Okay. Let me not introduce A inverse. Then what next?
Yeah. So we'll get, if we take out, if we take out A, one second, sir.
No problem. I mean.
Oh yeah, I got it. I don't know why. One second.
Okay, we'll come back to it, Anjali. Just collect your thoughts.
Yes, sir. So A square is A.
A square is A, fine.
Yeah, so you will get AB plus ABA, which is A inverse AI plus A.
If you multiply it again, that will be B.
No, sir. Take AB outside now.
Okay. If I take AB outside, it will become?
A inverse ABI plus A.
It will become
A.
B only, right? It will become this.
So If we write A inverse A, then we can say that AB should be 0.
No. A inverse A is reduced to an I, no?
Yes, sir. But if you don't write it like that, then we must say that AB should be 0 if the whole term should be 0.
Why? I can't comment on the two matrices which are multiplying to give you null, that any one of them will be null. No, I can't say that. It violates the very basic property that we did. If AB is null, we cannot say A is null or B is null or both are null. Correct? No?
So I'm understand, why can't we say that? See, anyway, A inverse is not null and B plus A is not null if we have to prove this. So AB should be null.
See, it doesn't matter. If any one of them is not null, we can still get a null. That is the whole point, no? Okay. If A is not null, B is not null, still we can get the answer as null. Okay.
Sorry, sir.
Yeah. Don't treat them like numbers. The problem is most of us, we treat matrices like our numbers. Okay. Since X into Y is 0 means one of them has to be 0. It is not true for matrices. It doesn't work for matrices.
Excuse me, sir. My power actually got cut. Do you mind repeating what you just said?
My discussion with Anjali or just in general?
Oh, it got cut when you were discussing it with Anjali. Did she get it right?
No, that was not correct argument. But she tried hard to do it. Well done. Okay.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, I had a doubt. Sir, you said that matrices are like transformations. Sir, what is a null matrix do?
It annihilates it completely. It makes that space reduced to a point. It makes that, it makes a vector reduced to a zero vector. Simple as that.
Okay, sir. So if we apply the nilpotent matrix n times, then it will get, it will just disappear.
Yes. So basically, if you apply that transformation multiple times, then what will happen? The combined effect of all those transformations will result into such a matrix which will make the entire vector space or 2D vector space or 3D vector space, that depends upon in what space you are applying that transformation, that will reduce to a point. Zero.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, so now we are moving towards orthogonal matrix. Orthogonal matrix. What is an orthogonal matrix? Again, it is a square matrix. Okay. Such that A into A transpose is A transpose A is equal to an identity matrix of the same order. So any matrix which performs this activity, A into A transpose is A transpose A equal to I, it will basically be a orthogonal matrix. Okay. Now, orthogonal matrix is very close to my heart. I remember my very first project in the field of wireless communication was on cancellation of noises in CDMA 2000 technology. So we used to imply orthogonal matrix, right, to cancel out any kind of noises which used to be carried along with the modulated signal. So it's very, very useful in wireless technology also. I'm just giving you an engineering application for it. Probably you may not take these matrices very seriously in class 11th or 12th, but later on when that becomes your profession, then you'll start respecting these same matrices. I'm sure people in the field of digital image processing would now be doing Aarti and all for matrices. They're so important. So, good old days for me. Let me give an example of an orthogonal matrix. So something like this, let me just make up an example. 1 by root 2 minus 1 by root 2, 1 by root 2, 1 by root 2. Okay. This is basically an orthogonal matrix of order 2. You can try multiplying it with its transpose. So the transpose here would be swapping the swapping the rows and the columns. Okay, so when you multiply, you can see the first row with the first column will give you half plus half, which is 1. The first row with the second column will give you a 0 completely. Second row with first column will give you again a 0. Second row with second column will give you a 1. So that gives you an I, which is nothing but this property. Okay, so this is an orthogonal matrix. Sure, Anahita.
Sir, could you just give an example of how to find transpose for a 3x3 matrix, sir?
Transpose of a 3x3, just change the rows to columns. Oh, okay, so let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So if the transpose of this is required, you just write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, what are the properties of orthogonal matrix?
Sir, should A into A transpose equal to A transpose into A? Is that a necessary condition or is it fine?
No, it comes automatically. It comes automatically.
Okay.
So, can we say that A transpose is also A inverse then?
Yes. So, from this, we can also imply that A transpose is the inverse of that matrix. Yeah, obviously. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Properties of orthogonal matrix. And we'll prove them as we go on. Number one, if A is orthogonal, so will be its transpose. Can you prove this? Now, this is very easy to prove. If A is orthogonal, it comes from the definition only.
So, yeah.
So basically, if you're saying this is true, right? Then A transpose into transpose transpose will be nothing but A transpose into A, which basically is governed by the fact that A into A transpose is A transpose into A, and hence even its transpose will be orthogonal in nature. Second property. If A and B are orthogonal matrices, so will be AB. Can we prove this? See, if A and B are orthogonal, that means A into A transpose and B into B transpose is I. I'm not writing the other part of it. And if you have to prove AB is orthogonal, that means you have to prove AB transpose is going to be I. This is what you have to
multiply the equation.
Okay. Now, if you open the transpose bracket, we all know the law of reversal. So it will be B transpose A. Correct? Sorry, B transpose A transpose. Now, this is going to be I as per this condition. So it will be A, I, A transpose. And you know that I doesn't make a difference. It just becomes A, A transpose. And from this condition, we can say it is back to I, which is your RHS, right? So if A and B are orthogonal, then AB will also be orthogonal. Same will be true for BA as well. Now, when such questions comes in the competitive exams, I've seen some people, they'll act very strange. They will take an example of two orthogonal matrix and try to convince themselves that it works. Instead, if you know these properties of transpose very well, you won't have to take an example and try to see which of the option is correct. That's why knowing the properties is very important. And lastly, even though I have not talked about inverse of the matrix so far, let me tell you, if A is orthogonal, so will be its inverse. Okay, by the way, the only property that is required here is, let's say if I tell you this property that AB inverse is equal to B inverse A inverse, that means it also follows the law of reversal. Can you prove this property? I think so, you will not even require this one also. But we have already mentioned the transverse properties. So if A is orthogonal, you know that this is correct, okay? And if you want to prove that A inverse is orthogonal, that means you have to prove somehow that this is I, correct? Now here, what we can do is, we can write it as A inverse, A transpose inverse, because as we all know that transpose and inverse positions can be swapped. Can I say this to be A transpose A whole inverse? Basically, I'm using the law of reversal in the opposite direction. Can I say this? Okay. And since A is an orthogonal matrix, we know A transpose is I. So basically, it is I inverse. I inverse is I itself. I is not affected even if you invert it. Is this fine? Anyways, these properties I will repeat once again when I'm doing inverse of a matrix with you.
So how do you get A inverse, A transpose inverse as A inverse transpose?
This is a property, you know, check the transpose property. Should I go back to this board?
Yes, inverse, it's okay.
You can just check on your notebook. For you, it will be just turn a couple of pages and you'll get it.
Yes, sir.
Did you find it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, we'll talk about questions based on them first, and then we'll move on to the main ones, symmetric and skew symmetric, which is going to be asked in your school as well. Let's take some questions first on them. Okay, so this is a column match question. Let us first match the A of column 1 to column 2. In your answer, please write it like this. A map to which of them? P, Q, R, S, or if multiple of them is matched, let me know. So let's say A is mapping to P and R. So like that, A map to P and R. Okay, Aditya has given one response.
Hello, sir.
Yes, tell me, Venkat.
Oh, you can hear me. Okay, sir. Could you go back to the previous page? After this question, of course.
After this question, okay, fine.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so most of you have replied. Let's discuss the first one. If A is idempotent means A square, in fact, higher powers will become all A. Correct? A cube will also become an A and so on. Now, I and A are commutative, right? So we can apply a binomial expansion on this. So I minus A to the power of N will be I to the power N, which is I, minus NC1A plus NC2A square minus NC3A cube and so on till I reach NCN. That depends upon N what sign I'll have over here. So I'll write it like this. Minus 1 to the power N, NCNA to the power N. Okay. Now I can see that all of these terms will be A only. So basically you are taking A and you are summing up NC1, NC2 all the way till NCN. Okay. Fine. Now what is this value? What is this value? We all know that NC0 minus NC1 plus NC2 minus NC3 till wherever it goes, let's say minus 1 to the power NCN, that is equal to 0, right? Correct. So can I say if I take all these terms to the right hand side, I'll end up getting this, and which is NC0, and NC0 is 1. So answer will be I minus A. So A will map to S. A will map to S. I think most of you got that.
Even like the normal definition itself, that's the thing, no, sir.
Okay. Oh yeah, and yes, if you do just do this, you will get an idea of the pattern. If you do A square, you'll end up getting I minus A into I minus A. That is nothing but I minus A minus A minus A square. Right? Sorry, plus A square. And this basically gives you I minus A again. Correct? So if you start going into a recursive relation, let's say if you do I minus A cube, then it will be just I minus A times I minus A, which is back to I minus A. So the answer would anyways come down to I minus A, which is going to be your option S. Is that what you're saying?
I have a doubt. Yes, sir. Kind of, but I have a doubt now.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, if A to the power N equal to A, that's the idempotent thingy. Does that mean something minus A also to the power N also is equal to that something minus A? Not in this case. It need not be I, for example.
So you're saying B minus A square will be B minus A if A is idempotent?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
We can't say so.
Okay.
So if both B and A are idempotent, then?
Then you can verify, no? So in this case, if both... And it should be commutative also.
Yes.
Correct? So if you're saying B minus A square and B and A are idempotent, so what will you end up getting? You'll end up getting minus B square minus AB minus BA plus A square. So what do you get?
Yes, sir.
So if this is B and this is A, no, I really doubt that information. No. How will you generate a B minus A over here?
Yes.
Okay, so you can figure it out on your
own. Yeah.
Sorry, the question was B now. Where you can say if A is idempotent, I minus A is definitely idempotent.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So,
one second.
Lot of people have responded. Can we discuss now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So A is involutory. Involutory means it is its own inverse. So A square is I, and so on and so forth. So okay. So can I say this is going to be I to the power n? Same expression over here. Okay. So let me not waste time writing it. Okay. So in this case, what will happen? A square will become I, A cube will again become an A, and so on and so forth, right? Correct? Yeah. So you'll end up seeing something like this. I minus NC1A plus again an I, again an A, and so on. That means I will have 1 plus NC2, NC4, and so on. And then minus A will have again NC1, NC3, and so on. Correct? Can I say each one of them was 2 to the power n minus 1? Okay. At least during the time when we did binomial. And I'm sure they will continue to be the same now also. So your answer will be P. So B will map to P.
So could you go right? Thank you, sir.
Okay, Venkat. C basically says A is nilpotent of index 2. That means 2 and onwards it will become. So this is very simple. So basically from here onwards you start getting a null. So it's I minus NA. So C will map to Q. C will map to Q. Okay. That means D has to map to R. Anyways, we'll verify it. If A is orthogonal, then A transpose inverse, what will it be?
Sir, it'll be A because A inverse is equal to A transpose.
Okay. So basically, it comes from the definition of orthogonal that A transpose is A inverse, correct? So basically you are writing A inverse inverse. Won't it be A again? If you invert an element twice, it'll give you the same element back. So D will map to R. Any questions here? Let's move on to the next question. Okay, now Venkat, you wanted me to go to the previous slide?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
One sec, sir. Yes, it on.
We'll take a nice question. Let me put the poll button on. Only one person has responded so far. See the pattern. In this case, you can easily answer by seeing the pattern. Okay, last 20 seconds, then I'll close the poll. All right, let's discuss this. I think enough time has been given for this. So this is the result for the poll. 41%, that is the maximum, has voted for C. Okay, let's see if C is correct or not. See, it's just a pattern observation. The moment we do A cube, okay, we realize we are doing A into 2A minus I, which is nothing but 2A square minus A. And A square is again the same term. So you may write it like this. That actually becomes 3A minus 2I. Okay. Now, from here onwards, we can start ruling out the options. Because when your N was, when N is your 3, neither this gives you the answer. Because this will give you 4A. Okay. Nor does this give the answer, nor this gives the answer. Only C is the right option in this case. Okay. But if you want, you can convince yourself even further by doing A4. A4 is nothing but A again multiplied to 3A minus 2I, which is nothing but 3A square minus 2A. And A is once again, A square is once again 2A minus I. So that will give you 4a minus 3a. So further, it emphasizes the fact that if you continue doing that, a to the power n, n being some positive integer, will become na minus n minus 1i. Okay.
Sir, could we go back 1 second?
Yeah, sure. Just give me a second. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Good.
Good?
Yes, sir.
Please try this question. This is a very, very famous question. It comes in many competitive exams. If P is an orthogonal matrix and Q is PAP transpose and X matrix is P transpose Q to the power 1000 P, then X inverse is A is involutory over here. Please note A is involutory. Multiple options can be correct. Okay. Last 20 seconds, then I'll discuss it. Please wrap this up. Okay, let's discuss this. See here, Q is PAP transpose and P is an orthogonal matrix, right? Now, if you find the matrix X, basically what are you writing? You're writing P transpose Q to the power 1000. Q to the power 1000 means you're writing this stuff 1000 times. Correct. If P is orthogonal, you would realize P into P transpose will be I. And again, P into P, P transpose will be I again. If you keep on doing it, basically you'll end up seeing that it'll form a chain like this. Okay. So even this will become an I. even this P with a P transpose before will become an I like this. So it'll be IA, 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 IA like that. Okay. So it'll become A to the power 1000. Right. Now, if A is an involutory matrix, then can I say this will be as good as I and will be as good as A itself, right?
A inverse.
Involutory matrix is basically A square is equal to I, correct?
I, yeah. A doing.
Sorry? Correct?
Yes, so, sir.
Any power raised on an involutory matrix, okay? So A cube will also be A. A4 will also be I and so on. So A 1000 will be I only. So I think B option is correct. And C option is correct. Is that fine? Next question.
Matrix is not what I thought it will be.
Matrices is not as easy as you thought it to be.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Now just remind me, I will just clarify that idempotent question doubt. A plus B will be idempotent when AB is equal to BA is equal to null. I've given enough time for you to respond. So I'll clarify that before I close the session. Oh, sorry, I forgot to put the poll on. Let's have the poll. Why not? We can have variables. No, we cannot differentiate a matrix, but we can differentiate a determinant. We can differentiate determinant. We can integrate determinant.
Oh, okay. So like directly or with expansion and
oh yeah, Anahita. Yes, Anahita, please. You're most welcome to clarify it. So Anahita will clarify that question, which we left. Sorry, Venkat, you were saying something?
Yes, sir. Like, do we integrate determinants and all by expansion and then normal integration?
There is a property which we'll talk about. Okay. Of course, expansion you can always apply.
Yes.
Okay, we'll close the poll in another 40 seconds. So those who have not responded, please do that. I have a slight doubt in the answer. Are you getting 2010 over here? Anybody?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Anyways, we'll see. If you feel that none of the options are correct, then do let me know on the chat box. Okay, let's end the poll and discuss it. I think. Okay, we'll see whether this poll result is correct or not, because I have slight doubt in the options. We'll check it out. See, if A and B are square matrices satisfying AB is equal to BA, sorry, AB is equal to A and BA is equal to B, what does it mean? That A and B are?
A and B are idempotent.
Idempotent. Okay, the moment you see this, the property should come in your mind that A and B are idempotent. Okay. If A and B are idempotent, we know that in idempotent matrix, if you raise any power, it will be the same matrix, right? Ultimately, it will be this only, correct? So these powers are just scaring you off. It is just A plus B actually. So it's A plus B to the power 2011. Correct? Does everybody agree so far with me?
Yes,
that A to the power 2010 and B to the power 2010 are nothing but A plus B only. Okay. Now what I'm going to do here is, I'll just do a simple pattern check. I'll do A plus B square. Okay. And this gives you A square plus B square plus AB plus BA. Okay. Which is back to A plus B. And AB is A and BA is B. So again, A plus B. So you'll get 2 times A plus B. Okay. If you continue with this, that means if you do A plus B to the power, let's say 3, you'll end up getting 2A plus B square, which is back to 2A plus B. So 2 into 2A plus B. So what I'm seeing here is that this A plus B doesn't change, but this power is one less than this index, correct? So since you're going till 2011, I doubt whether this will go to 2011, it'll go to 2010. So option D is correct, but with a minor correction over here. So please make a change. Sorry, I didn't foresee that.
So,
there's a mistake. Yeah.
So could you do this using binomial theorem?
But for binomial, AB and BA should be equal, na? For binomial expansion to work, AB should be equal to BA. So who told that A and B are equal? There's no such.
No, sir, I'm asking like how you've used like you started with 2 and 3. Could you just expand this using binomial theorem and collect all the terms?
No, we can't do binomial theorem. No, we can't write this as A square plus B square plus 2AB. This cannot be written like this. That will only work when AB and BA are same. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, now, Anita, can you just explain that question? Can you go back? I don't know which slide number was that also. We can do it separately. I mean, it doesn't take much of a time. So the property was A and B were idempotent, correct? And the question was A plus B will be idempotent if and only if AB is equal to BA is equal to null. Yeah, Anita, can you just unmute yourself and say?
So yes, sir.
Start with this discussion that we reached here. After this, what?
Yeah. Sir, if you multiply B on the right side, post facto.
Okay, post facto B here. Okay. So if you
you get AB square plus BAB is 0.
Is null.
Yeah. And you can write B square as B because.
Very good.
I don't know.
That means.
And you can write AB as minus BAB.
Very good. Yeah, carry on. You're on the right track.
And then you multiply prefacto AB plus BA.
Again, multiply prefacto with?
Multiply AB plus BA again.
Okay. So can I do one thing? Oh, sorry, what did you say?
Multiply AB plus BA prefacto now by B.
You can do one thing. You can multiply prefacto with a B, no?
Yes, sir. That's what I said.
Yeah. So now this will be B again.
Yeah. And correct. You get
very B good. Is correct. So BA is also minus BAB. Correct. So basically, she proved that these two are equal because both are equal to the same expression, right? Correct. Now, putting it back over here, if AB and BA are equal, it means each has to be equal to the null matrix. Very good, Anahita. Awesome. Is this fine? All right, so let me tell you, we are just done with half the topic of matrices. Other half still will take 4 hours. I'm sorry, I had a misjudgment about the length of the concept, so it will take us more time to do it. We have to still do symmetric, skew symmetric, Hermitian, skew Hermitian, elementary transformations. Then we have to do Martin's rule. And we have to do, mostly that's it. And then we can start with a determinants concept. Anyways, thank you so much. I'll stop here. Hope you have now a different perspective about matrices. So it's not a chapter to be done on your own. You definitely need some kind of guidance here. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good night.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.